right.
Please join us for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much and good evening and welcome to the Hampton Board of Selectmen's meeting for November 28th. First thing we have is public comment period. Is there anybody here from the public that would like to speak?
Hi.
Come right up to the microphone, please.
Hi. I'm just going to yell really loud. Great. Hi, I'm Sarah Lang. I live in the town of Hampton at 7 Acadia Ave. And I'm here to talk about a potential four-way stop sign and speed bumps at the intersection of Acadia, Bonaire, and Thorwald. So the intersection of Acadia, Bonaire, and Thorwald is a public safety hazard. There is currently only a two-way stop sign, which allows cars to speed on Acadia and poses a dangerous threat to anyone walking, driving, bicycling, or living in the area. Most recently, in September, there was an accident that resulted in three cars being totaled, including one that was parked in a driveway at a resident's home. In addition, this intersection is an elementary school bus stop. Therefore, children are put at risk as they go to and come home from school. Our ask is that the town makes this intersection of Acadia, Bonaire, and Thorwald a four-way stop sign, or a four-way stop, and puts speed bumps in the intersection to reduce the safety hazard that currently exists and to avoid the potential for tragic accidents in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else who would like to speak? Public comment? Seeing none, announcements and community calendar. Regina?
Nothing, Mr. Chairman.
Do you want to speak? Oh, sorry, I didn't see a hand up. I'm sorry. Good evening, Betty.
Good evening, Betty Moore, 375 Ocean Boulevard. I'm actually here on behalf of the Hampton Historical Society, and we would like to invite the community to an open house this coming Sunday on December 4th from 1 to 3. We would love to have you join us. We have refreshments, exhibits. Santa might be paying a visit. And there'll be a cocoa bar in the barn, and there'll be all kinds of things for the community. So we hope you can join us. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Anybody else in the public? Okay. Regina.
I don't have anything, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Jim?
Mr. Chairman, good. Hope everybody had a happy Thanksgiving. And this Friday night, December 2nd, at 6:30 p.m. in Morelli Square is the lighting, the Christmas tree lighting. And it's always a fun event and a fun event for everybody to come to. There's food there. There's some refreshments, hot chocolate. There's a horse-drawn wagon for people, little kids and stuff, take a ride on. So it's at 6:30, Morelli Square, December 2nd. And I hope everybody makes it there.
Very good. Bill?
No comments, Mr. Chairman.
Bert?
I just wanted to comment on, there was an article in the paper this week about how poorly attended the veterans presentation was. And there was a limited crowd there, I will tell you that. But who's to say exactly why that is? Maybe because the election was here and everybody was busy, whatever, but there could have been more people there. I don't think there were more than 20 people. But in the article, it was stated that there was no one there representing the town. It just isn't true because Jim Waddell and I were both there, standing in the front row, not lurking in the crowd. And we were standing up. I was standing next to some of the town first responders. So, you know, we were there. There was a presence. And it is unfortunate that there probably weren't more people there, but it still was a wonderful presentation that day, and I think everyone that was there really enjoyed it, and I would urge more people to go there in the future.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to commend the and add to those remarks that American Legion does a great job. Commander Fitzello, we had a Marine Corps birthday party the night before. It was a late night for me, and I was on my way to New York at 3 in the morning, so I couldn't attend. But Chief Sawyer was there, keeping us all well supervised. But it is great stuff, and sometimes people don't get out to those things, but they are important to attend. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Rick.
Okay. I'd like to remind everybody of the Hampton Christmas Parade on Saturday. The parade starts at 1 o'clock. I think they're shutting down Route 1 about 12:15.
About 12:15
we'll start. So just plan accordingly. It's a good time to go out. The parade is good. There's going to be a number of places along the route. They're going to have the music in the air, and they're going to have refreshments in other places. So if you do get there a little early, you can try some of the local restaurants or stuff that are going to do that. We are videoing that from Channel 22. But they have some entertainment downtown, I believe. And there's a couple other places they are. So if you get a chance to go to the Christmas parade, it's a great time we'll have it all. And I think Santa Claus is going to be there, too. So very good. He's getting busy this time of year. All righty, the next thing we have is the consent agenda. We don't have anything on there.
That's correct.
That's good. Approval of minutes, November 7th, 2006, public session.
I'll make the motion to approve November 7, 2016.
Second.
16, yes. All those in favor? Unanimous. November 14th, 2016.
Make the motion to approve.
Motion seconded by Phil. All those in favor? Unanimous. Appointments. We have the Hampton School Board. And I believe the superintendent is also with them. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for having us. My name is Les Shepherd. I'm chair of the Hampton School Board. Ginny Russell Bridle, Frank DeLuca, our superintendent, Kathleen Murphy, and Pepper Ring. Mrs. Shepherd cannot be here tonight. A couple of things. We thought we could update you on where we are with the Hampton Academy renovation. We are going forward with that. That's going to be a warrant article. I believe the cost, I don't have the exact figure, but it is about 26? 25.9 million dollars. And that's a lot of money. We understand that. And we understand that you folks may have some significant warrant articles also. But the facility is outdated. It doesn't meet the kids' needs. This is the cheapest way that we can renovate that building. And we're hoping that people don't kick the can down the road because, again, it's just not going to go away. I'll pass these out to you folks. Just
sure.
So I'm sure in addition to what we're passing out to you now, there will be a lot of discourse in the coming months about this. We urge people to ask questions, contact the superintendent if they do have questions. I will say that there were approximately 35 people from all cross-section of Hampton. Selectman Waddell was on the committee. There were people representing the PTO, people representing parents. There were people who were against the project on the committee. And when it was all said and done, people were, I'd say, unanimously in agreement to go forward with this project. And this is a major renovation. Ginny, would you?
The second project is one that we're going to need the selectmen's help with, excuse me, or work as a joint committee because it's the Safe Routes to Schools project. And we had the town's representatives, the school representatives, and the planner, I think, was there at the time. And we had a Safe Routes to School committee, which decided that the intersections in town going to the schools needed some serious work. We had a cost brought up, and unfortunately, when it went out to bid last spring, the cost over exceeded the budget. So we need to, again, present that. We need to especially pay attention to Central School. That is a very tight spot in the morning and not a safe place. We also, with the new academy project, we need to make the sidewalks and the crosswalk at Hampton Academy safe. And we also have to address the intersection at High Street and Mill Road, because that's a very serious. We have a lot of students that go up and down a High Street to go to school. So we really need to address that. So we're hoping that the selectmen will work with us and in securing some funds, because as we well recognize, we have the students, but you have the sidewalks. So that's why we'd like to work together and make Hampton a safer place to walk around. So that's where we are with Safe Routes to School.
I'll jump in for a bit. I taught at Center School, and I never had bus duty. It was always a duty that other people did, not teachers. So when I started dropping off my grandsons at Center School, then I really got an eye-opening experience. As you know, people park on Toll Ave. People park here. Yeah, we have the main crosswalk. Thank heavens for Louise Moore. She keeps everybody in hand. But then again, it's the crosswalk out here opposite Ross Apartments and the end of that chain link fence that I never even realized it was there until I got out of the car and took, you know, my grandson to the crosswalk with Louise, and I'm like, oh my gosh. I mean, the buses are pulling right out where the crosswalk is. We have two runs of buses that come in, not just one, because we share with Marston. So that's also a problem, but you know, we're handling it as best we can. Thank heavens there has been no accidents. But that is a really big concern. On the other side, you know, watching everybody and the comings and the goings of all the parents and the children. Sometimes I get a little nervous. They do have to stick to the inside of the fence once they get in there on Center School property. A lot of them walk their kindergarten children to that door to get in on the east side of the building. But it is really concerning for me. As Judy said also, Marston School's tight. I don't know how the buses get in and out. I truly don't know how they get in and out of there, how one can come out and one can go in. And again, they have two runs of buses, because we share the buses with Marston School. And then the academy. Again, picked up a grandson this year, and I got one at the academy. You know, and you go down the road, and it's, you know, crosswalk here, crosswalk here, crosswalk here. One for the library, another one out at the end, you know, for Winnicunnet Road. So it's a lot of crosswalks. So we're hoping when the school passes that the children will have a bus route and the parents will have a route also to drop off the children, so that they're not going to be crossing Academy Ave, and there'll be a courtyard for them to go into. So we really have a lot of concerns when it comes to crosswalks and the buses coming and going. It's a really big concern. I just feel very fortunate that we've had no accidents, and Louise Moore keeps everybody in line at yes, Center School, because it's a lot of traffic in the morning.
The other part of that is, we'll use this as a public service announcement, parents need to slow down. Whether you're using the Marston School parking lot, whether you're using Hobbs House parking lot, Center School, slow down, because we're having problems with that as well. So if we all work together, we can make it safe for our children to go to school.
Okay. Next item. Last year in the town warrant, Article 36, there was an article which passed overwhelmingly, as 2,800 thereabouts to 600, to convey the Arnold property and the Martell property to the school district if the renovation passed. So the renovation didn't pass. So we're hoping that you'll put that on the warrant again this year.
I believe we already have that in our draft warrants to put together, so that's good.
Thank you.
And while you're on the safe routes to schools, We've also had somebody talk to us about the speed limit, the school speed limit along here, and we're gonna talk about that later on too. More or less, just lengthening it out to get it down, maybe past my first student or whatever. No, the what's the little
my first school.
My first school. Yeah. So in the morning, that will be in that part of that area too.
I mean, just to start there and then get them used to it.
Well, they have to go up one Academy Ave or here, so it's all right in the same spot.
It's all right in the same area. That's excellent. Thanks.
The next to last thing was the cable channel. Help me out on this one.
Well, I think first of all, we're all very appreciative of the board identifying our needs. We share that with you, and then allocating about $67,000. That was last month's meeting, and we are very appreciative because that can really help us to grow our station. And I think I said that the last time, but I think one of the comments that the board heard and I heard was a comment by Mr. Waddell about us working together. And we really, as you know, the board has really been, whatever we can do to help has been kind of their motto. Whether it was safe routes to school or whatever the issue is, I think Chief has an event that he wants to share. We'll help out in any way we can because they are committed to community. So how can we work together to really grow both Channel 13 as well as your Channel 22? And so I didn't know if we could have a conversation about that tonight. What were you thinking about? But certainly we have some capacity in terms of talented staff. You certainly have capacity for talented staff. And I just was trying to figure out ways in which we can work together. Because the cable stations are just, they're arms of each other. I mean, if you had an emergency in town, our station goes down and you take over. That was always part of the intermunicipal agreement that we signed. We want to be able to, if we reach a certain stakeholder in town, we want to be able to advertise your events on our station. So, and vice versa, as we do now anyway. Channel 22 covers a lot of the board activities. So I think that's where we were headed in terms of the cable, because it has been a tremendous, tremendous asset to Hampton SAU 90. The schools love it. The kids love it. They've grown an appreciation now of TV production, and it's been a very, very powerful tool for us in terms of student learning. And that was because of the franchise monies that we were able to acquiesce. So maybe Jim can share a little bit about his thinking. And
my thinking was on that specifically was that, you know, people from the school get together with people with the 22 group. And when we're buying equipment and stuff, that we kind of coordinate to make sure we're staying in the same equipment, so that one isn't operating on a different system than the others, you know, and just a little bit more cooperation or communication. I don't think it's necessarily a lack of cooperation. I think it's just that communication hasn't been there between, you know, you've come to the selectmen and stuff, and then we've done it, and we've sort of bypassed the 22 people, and we want to make sure we keep them involved in everything. So I just think, you know, with your group, maybe getting together with the 22 group and talking through things and working on what equipment everybody's purchasing and how it's, you know, set up and stuff like that.
Would you suggest that we have a board rep that we meet to go, or is it?
Well, right now you have John.
Does it suffice? John Judson has been attending,
yeah.
Our media coordinator. John's only part-time, as you know.
Yeah.
But he's more than willing,
yeah,
to. John and I had a chance to chat after,
right,
the last meeting, and he's more than willing to.
But I think that, you know, with him, and I think it'll continue to go, and I just think open up communication a little more will work fine.
I think one of the things we saw was when you brought your proposal for, you had the, and I probably got it wrong, CNET or C, the thing you're replacing.
Oh, right.
Is that,
right,
CNET? Is that
right? And because you had that original
Nexus
piece of
Nexus
equipment was yours. The Nexus was yours.
Right.
Right.
And talking, right, to our cable guys, they also are looking at down the road going to this CNET, because,
right,
that's the wave of the future.
Right.
And I think for me, it was just didn't know a CNET from a A-note. So.
Right. The Nexus system couldn't be replaced. And when we knew that we needed to replace it, in order to have the capacity to run what we were doing, we had to go to that. And
right.
Knowing that we couldn't, you know, do anything with Nexus, so.
Right. And so, and the other thing was, is that we've talked about is your ability, you have your own studio, and I believe you're doing that with the school, with the Hampton Academy renovations. Is there anything beyond that?
Well, that was huge. When we did the initial survey of community people, mm-hmm. we also surveyed the kids and the teachers, you know, because this is their environment. And the kids really have just latched on to this TV production where they're doing live productions. They've actually presented at conferences. They're presenting at the statewide conference at Krista McAuliffe. They were at the Massachusetts statewide technology. They blew people away. I mean, these kids have become naturals. And some people say, well, isn't this kind of fluff? Well, frankly, the standards require communication for kids. So we know that speaking, listening, and viewing are the standards now in English language arts. And so this is just a way in which to do
fit.
That, a natural path for the kids. The other piece is that when Hampton Academy moved away from being a junior high, part of that was the tech ed program. Remember what some of us knew as the woodshop program? Those programs have somewhat gone away, and this program really replaces it, but it's technology based in terms of the kids building components, running all the equipment and the machines. So it has replaced it, and because of that, Rusty, the committee, the facilities committee that Les referred to, overall supported a studio. One that would be able to use for the kids, of course, but also be able to use for their meetings. And we'd be able to broadcast our own meetings and have the appropriate equipment there to do that job.
I think it'd be great. Rick, you have a question?
Yeah, I like the idea about having the representative and maybe vice versa.
So
I think it's a good idea.
In terms of the committee?
Coming to Channel 22 and maybe 22 going to your meetings or whatever, however it has to be. I think it's a good idea. Keep everybody on the same wavelength.
Any other?
Oh, thank you, school board. Thank you, superintendent.
Okay, talk about the other
good luck on your school project.
Yeah, thank you.
I know you were close last year.
Very close.
And we'll be talking up in Concord with the delegation, and there is a movement up there that debases our revenue system here in town, and it's done, and it's expensive. I'll be talking later on this evening where in the last 3 years it's been over $1 million, and that bonds a lot of programs. We're looking at our warrant articles tonight. Legislators up there don't get the message. One faction says we can't do new taxes, but they will vote to give what some would call crony capitalist tax deductions. The same companies that are taking us to court for valuations, same corporations that set precedent on a poll where the bottom half or the top half, whether you look at it, is set at a different rate. And we'll be addressing those issues because there's a lot of our money that is taken from us, and it stays up in Concord. So we'll be fighting that fight. And the more of it we can keep here, it's fair and honest, the better you folks will be doing on the school side of the house. And we wish you luck. And I don't speak for the board, but we support you. And the better the municipal side will be doing. But thank you for the great work. Thank you for your leadership and a great school system.
Just a comment. I did attend a legislative forum, I guess, in Exeter 2 weeks ago. And there were a number of legislators there. And I had an opportunity. They allowed me to speak to the school building aide. And I was told by a number of legislators that there would be some bills in session this time on school building aid, and that there was an openness to really going back and looking at that building aid. So I want you to know that the board decided to go ahead, and we've already submitted an application. Now, we realize that that's a bit presumptuous. However, we felt that if we were aggressive and we showed our desire for some of the building aid money, that at least our application would be at the top of the pile. And given the gravity and needs over at Hampton Academy, I think we can prove that. So with your support up there, I think it would be very helpful.
Thank you.
Jim, you had something?
No, I just wanted to, I mean, I am the selectman's representative on the school building committee there, and, you know, I support totally what they've been talking about here. You know, we're talking about a 21st century education being taught in a 19th century building. And the teachers there are doing a phenomenal job teaching 21st century, and the facilities people are doing a phenomenal job keeping it up. But I think it's time that we take a look at it and decide that we're going to do something with that building and move forward with the school. I mean, it is the 21st century. We are a town that wants to support their students, and we need to do more of that. On the safe streets to school, is safe. I agree with that 200%. I mean, it's such a shame. My granddaughter, who lives on the west side of the highway, goes to Center School and loves to walk to school on Fridays. And I'm just in a panic every time that she walks to school, she and her friends, because they have to cross Route 1 there. And it just, you know, what are we thinking? You know, you had students, you want students to walk, you don't want everybody on a bus, you want people to get exercise, and then you have a terribly unfriendly pedestrian area. So I support those 100%. And I think the town needs to look at it. Citizens need to look at it.
Yeah, as far as the safe routes to school, 100% I agree with Jim. You know, I dropped my niece off at Center, and now she's at Marston. And, I mean, when I pick her up, I'm getting there like 20, 25 minutes early just so I don't need to deal with it. Never mind when it gets busy and the buses start coming in. And as far as what Superintendent Murphy said, I don't think you're being presumptive at all. I say go for it, because I think that we need to start doing that as a town. We need to figure out what our priorities are, what we need to get done, and we need to go after and get the aid for that. So I commend you.
We will be there with our voices to be heard. The board has asked Nathan and I to be present at any hearings so that we can share what Hampton needs. And I'm somewhat accustomed to testifying there, so I feel like I know the ropes a little bit, and we'll be able to spread the word about the needs in Hampton, because it is time for that building. If it isn't this year, then we have to really rethink about what we will do with the roof. I mean, I've been kind of saying we'll hold off on the roof, you know, and because it's cheaper to do these things in whole than it is piecemeal. We've already done that. We went through that. And I think by looking at the whole project, it's cheaper in the long run. But I don't think that I can tell the board to hold off anymore. I can't. I can't do that anymore with things like air quality, like the roof system, like major drainage there, just simple drainage. The reason why we have leaks on the flat roof is because the drainage is all backed up. So we have major issues there that we have to take care of. And to piecemeal it, it will cost our community more money in the long run than it would if we, I know it's that price tag is a lot, but over the course of I think it's a 25-year bond this time. They went with a 25 instead of a 20, sort of lengthen it out, more people paying for it over time, will help bring that cost down a little bit also for the folks in town.
Excellent.
Do I sound passionate about this project? I'm
a little
sorry.
Bit. Just a little bit, but that's good. The last thing we have on here is the scheduling for the photo shoot.
Oh, right.
Yay, something we all look forward to.
We all do. One of the things we're going to do is we thought that the appropriate thing was the town clock.
I thought that was an awesome idea.
Where it's on school property, why not all get together and do it at the same time?
So how would you like to do that? Before the snow flies?
Can you tell when that's going to be?
All I know is when I have to call school off, not when it's...
Yeah, we probably should, the sooner the better, so we can get the both either your report or our reports out.
Right,
so we need to get that picture done sooner than later.
Yes.
What are you looking at, Fredo? Did Christina come up with anything?
She hasn't given me anything at this point.
But okay.
Do you want me to work
whatever is mutual.
Do you want me to work with Christina?
Why don't you work with Christina and find out a date that's suitable for you guys and us? And we'll come up with a date sooner than later.
Okay.
And that way there we can get it done. I think it's going to be fun. It's going to be, and it'll be good. It shows a good cooperation that we've had this year, well, with the police and, I mean, with the schools and the in the town. I think it'll make an excellent cover for the town report. So.
Great.
Thank you for having us. I know time's precious, so we'll be on our way.
We're glad you're here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next one up is Chief Sawyer. And I don't have the gentleman's...
The colonel that was originally scheduled, Tone, is had a personal matter to attend to, so in his stead is Master Sergeant Bill Polino, United States Marine Corps, retired. Look, come on over here, take a seat. And Bill serves as the staff NCO with the Winnicott High School Marine Corps Junior ROTC program.
Very good. Thank you.
Basically coordinating this event for us. The event we're here to talk about is Wreaths Across America. And Billy's going to give you a little background on that program. We're looking to have this event on December 12th up in front of the Legion Post on High Street. So I'm going to let Billy give you some details of what the event is, and then I'll give you the overview of how we plan to achieve it.
Good evening. Thanks for having me, first off. So Wreaths Across America is a nonprofit organization that every year, at the beginning of December, begins a journey from upstate Maine with a large caravan. They head down along the coast, with their end state being in Arlington National Cemetery, where they place wreaths at all the gravestones down there of the nation's fallen and veterans. This year, as in I think several years past, they've wanted to stop here in the town of Hampton. 1 year, I believe they did it at the Marine Memorial down on the beach, and then another year here in the past at the high school. We thought they kind of partnered with us to kind of take the reins on it, so what we thought and figured the best course of action scenario would be to just do it like we would, like we normally do here in the town with the 9/11 ceremony out in front of the Legion, where we have our 9/11 monument. And one of the other things that they're doing different this year with the wreaths that we've talked to them about is they'll also be honoring some first responders, which, you know, in the past few years here, we've lost several.
So the date is again December 12th. The rough time, and keep in mind they're coming down out of northern Maine. They have a lot of stops to make. We're hoping that we can get them here into town by 1 o'clock on the 12th. The route they'll come in, they're going to come in from Northampton on Route 1. We plan on bringing them down Route 1 to Winnicott Road, Winnicott Road to Mill, and then Mill onto High Street. So they'll be pointing westbound on High Street. We plan on this, a difference in the number of trucks that we can anticipate. We're talking anywhere from 12 to 20 full-size tractor-trailer units loaded with the wreaths, plus an entourage of about another 15 to 20 vehicles. So our goal is to double-stack the vehicles on High Street, extending back probably past Academy Ave. So we're going to have to shut down for the duration from Dearborn to Mill Road on High Street. And we have some other parking areas that we're going to set up so we can keep the front of the Legion clear for the crowd we anticipate. The entourage coming down out of Maine is going to be in excess of 100. Then I anticipate we'll probably have a lot of participation by local veteran groups, first responder groups, police and fire that are going to be standing out in front of the Legion. One concern we had was dealing with the bus routes for the schools. Deputy Chief Hobbs has been coordinating with the superintendent and the principal to make that work. Everybody's on board. It's just a matter of timing. So what we're looking for is permission to detour roads and shut down roads for that short period on the 12th to achieve this event.
Any questions or comment from the board?
I think we should support it 100%.
So moved. The chief's operations order.
A motion by Phil, seconded by Rick. All those in favor? Unanimous.
With your permission, I also would like to read the proclamation. You folks were kind enough to prepare for this into the record, if that's
sure.
Okay. A proclamation, Wreaths Across America. Whereas the town of Hampton has always honored the sacrifices of the men and women in the armed forces of the United States of America, and whereas Wreaths Across America was formed to make sure that we remember the blood sacrifices of the members of our armed forces in securing freedom and liberty for our fellow Americans, and whereas Wreaths Across America seeks to honor our fallen patriots by the proper decoration of their final resting places during Christmas of each year, and whereas Wreaths Across America has honored the town of Hampton, New Hampshire by visiting our community, conducting ceremonies in remembrance of the Hampton and New Hampshire military heroes of our armed forces,
And whereas we, the people of Hampton, New Hampshire, wish to express our sincere gratitude to Wreaths Across America for their great efforts, often a personal sacrifice in rededicating all of us to the final sacrifice made by our fellows in securing our freedom. And whereas the people of Hampton wish that the sacrifice of so many of in our armed forces never be forgotten through the efforts of Wreaths Across America. Now, therefore, we, the Board of Selectmen of the Town of Hampton, do hereby proclaim the month of December to be Wreaths Across America month for the honors that they give to our military heroes. In testimony whereof, we have hereunto set our hands this 14th day of November in the year of our Lord, 2016, in the 378th year of incorporation of the Town of Hampton, the 337th year of the founding of New Hampshire, and the 240th year of independence of the United States of America. And it's signed by Russell D. Bridle, Chairman, James A. Waddle, Vice Chairman, Richard P. Griffin, Philip W. Bean, Regina M. Barnes, Board of Selectmen. Thank you very much for this.
You're welcome. You're welcome. And thank you, gentlemen, for all you do with this and everything else you do for us in town.
It'll be a nice event. Hope everybody can attend. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chief. Thanks, Mr. Sergeant.
Thanks.
Next one we have up is Christina.
No, Christy.
Christy, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Okay. I'll get Christina. Have her come.
Christy, sorry about that.
That's okay. All right, so I'm here with the monthly financials for October. You guys, I think, got them in your mailbox early last week. So, and I emailed them off to you. They are also on the website and sent to the Budget Committee. It's the 10th report for 2016 with a target of 83.33%. The total month's income was $662,954. Of that total, motor vehicles came in at 291,300, which is over the month's target by $43,300. The other major contributors to the month's total were interest on taxes at $6,714, building permits at $27,478, highway subsidy at $88,789, state water pollution at $100,075. Other state revenues at $63,538. Departmental income at $47,357. Parking lots at $2,528. The Rye Sewer Agreement at $16,234. Other dividends at $2,884. That's a new program that we have started a while ago with. We have a credit card from Citizens Bank, and we're earning back dollars on that credit card. So that's for two quarters, I believe, the $2,884. We just started using it. So it's just another income source that we have tried to take advantage of for the town. Donations at $6,612 and the real estate trust at $36,079. The expense summary at the end of October, the operating departments without debt service but with open POs were at 78.8% of the budget, which is under the month's target by 4.53% or $1,092,364. In October of 2015, we were at 80.87 compared to the 78. So it was fairly, we're up basically at close to the same place this year as we were last year at this time. Overall, the departments as a whole are running under the target of 83.33%. I'll just run through some of the different departments who some of the lines are a little higher than the target. The town manager supplies and expense line is at 125%. Town clerk is at 83.19%. Most of that's related to their software agreement for their software that they use, their contract, the maintenance contract. MIS is at 71.4%. Some of the lines there are over the target, but if you include those four lines that repairs and maintenance, new equipment, replacement equipment, and supplies and expenses together, they're only at 58.4. And the staff development is over target at 121. That's related to both of the gentlemen in those two IT positions recently attended some classes up in Portsmouth. The legal department as a whole is under the target. The line item here that is over is outside council fees at 119.73%. Cemeteries as a whole are under target, and some accounts to note there are telephone at 133.35%, heating fuel at 100.3%, and repairs and maintenance at 113.87%. The parking administration is at 105.36%, so they've gone over budget there. They did have a few concerts in November, so that number will change slightly. The police department as a whole is at 81.47% when you include the open purchase orders. Fire department is at 78.02% when you include their open purchase orders. Hydrants is at 97.03%, which is, we've made both the payments there, so that will stay at that percentage. Department of Public Works is at 75.53% with the open purchase orders. Mosquito control is at 93.2%. Welfare is at 74.46. I just noted there again that the public assistance for rent is over the target. Culture and recreation is at 73.18%. Patriotic purposes is at 114.73%. The 2015 encumbrances are now 91% expended. And then when you get into the special revenue funds, the recreation fund has a balance of $164,006. The cable committee fund balance is $176,753. Private detail, the fund balance is $124,815. EMS, the balance in the account is $428,122. And the water system development charge, the fees collected in 2016 now total $54,804. With a balance in that account of $169,477. And that is all.
All right. We'll start with Rick. Want to start?
I don't have any questions. Thank you for your report.
You're welcome.
Bill?
Director, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Regina?
Just one number six out, the $1,092,364 that we're under target by, which is not really much different than it was last year, if you look at the percentage. And I would probably, we can anticipate that that number has changed or probably will go down.
Yes, I mean, I'm sure it's already changed since this report was done. I think that a lot of the departments tend to hold off on some of their spending until the season is over, because being a seasonal community, you never know what to expect in the summer, what you're going to get. And so, like I said, that number is very close to where we were in October of last year, and we didn't end with that much. So I do expect it to drop.
All right. Thank you for the clarification.
Sure. Christy, thanks for your report. And, you know, I think it's important for people to realize that you do this every month and that it's posted online every month.
It is.
So people in town can go to this report and go line by line and see exactly what's being spent.
Yes.
So that it's totally transparent on where the money's coming in, where the money's coming out, whether we're in line, whether the budget's in pretty good shape, or we're, you know. So I think that's important for people to realize, and that you also are watching it fairly closely to see if, even though there are some lines over, but that everybody's staying within their budget, and if we're going to end up with any problems. So I think that's well done, and I think it's, people should realize that, and they should realize the transparency, that they can go and they can look at this, they can see it, they can figure out exactly where the town's spending its money. So
and usually once we do the November financials, then Fred and I usually almost monitor it on a weekly basis. He and I are looking at it, and I'm almost generating these reports weekly. They're not always distributed, but Fred and I are at least watching it once the November financials are done. For those last 4 weeks in December, we're usually generating this on a weekly basis every time we do payroll and payables.
Right.
We sit down and look at it.
So thank you very much for that.
And just looking at the EMS fund.
Yes.
I mean, it looks really big when it says it's got $425,000 in there, but in all actuality, that is the potential we will have for that. Am I correct?
That's balance at the end of October in that account.
Right, but that also includes money that will potentially come in.
Correct. Oh, yes. Sorry.
It's,
yep.
It's not an actual
because we booked
figure.
The revenues at the time of the bill.
Right.
Yes.
And there are many ambulance calls that over the years that end up getting written off due to lack of pay or non-payment. So
correct.
That figure is a figure, but it is fluctuates.
Yep.
So So we don't have that much money sitting in a bank account someplace.
No, we do not.
So, thank you. Anything else from the board? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Christy, you always do a good job.
Thanks.
Next one we have is Brian McCain from Cable Committee.
Hello.
How are you, Brian?
Good. We as a committee have been looking at our equipment and finding that a lot of it is 10 plus years old and out of date and needing a replacement. And now that we've gotten a few more dollars from the cable fund, we'd like to do it. It's something we couldn't do in the past. I gave you a list of the equipment we think is needs to be replaced sooner than later. First one being a data video, portable switcher, which will replace our Anycast, which does all the outside videoing, the Christmas parade, the town meeting and such. The second is it's a high definition recorder. All this is going to be high definition too. Is a recorder that is basically taking the place of a DVD player. Everything's going to this. Instead of putting it on a DVD, you put it on a high definition a recorder and then download it into the system. The next are camera controllers, and I'll put the two together, camera controllers and tripods. Basically, what they're going to replace is the ones we have now. They're 10 plus years. I don't know how old they are because they were here before I was here. And they're all, most of them we have taped up and the legs are bent on some of the tripods. And like you say, we make do with them and they're doable, but they're old. And the last one is a powered mixer. It's a 16 input powered mixer. And what that'll do, I have mixers now, but I have only four input. So I have to put them together. And anything to do with sound, when you're not professionally trained, as we're not, it makes it very difficult. And that's where we have problems at some of the meetings, where we get feedback. This will not only do all the mics, but it also power the speakers, where I don't have, right now, I have a mixer for the mics, and then I have to jump it over to the speakers, an amp to power the speakers. Well, this will do it all. So, and the only other thing that I forgot to put on here was all this, we need new cables because this will all be HD. And the cables I have now are digital, but they're not HD cables. So that would be like another $500 for a good assortment of cable lengths. And that's it.
Any questions for Brian?
Brian, this was all put out to bid, right? So you have three bids on each one?
Well, yeah, quotes. I have quotes on
three quotes.
Yeah.
Three quotes on each one.
Each one, yeah.
And the other thing is that when you're talking going high def,
mm-hmm.
because we do get a lot of people calling that the quality's not very good.
Right. This
sound is terrible.
Yeah, the sound is that's down the road. We're going to address that with maybe we found an individual that we feel will really help us in that area because we've had other people and they didn't help. So we need somebody that's really qualified can take it to the next level.
And the age of most of the equipment you just said was?
10 plus years. I don't know. We don't have any records on them, unfortunately, that I found.
It's technology equipment.
It's they're all obsolete. Like the Anycast, to fix that would cost, or even maintenance or anything happens, would be over $5,000. So it's not worth it. It was $15,000 when it was new, and this new one to replace it, it's $5,500. So, and the, like I said, the, the DVD players, you just don't, they're just standard DVD players now. They don't make the commercial ones. They go to the hard drives. And then the tripods and the controllers, those are just old. And they're obsolete also. You can't fix them anymore. And like I said, the mixer is just something that would make it life easier on me
people realize that it's not just that there's money there and you want to spend it.
No, it's not.
That you want to upgrade the system.
Yeah, we want to upgrade. Because we've never been able to do it. We just keep going because we get what we need to keep going. But now...
And how many meetings do you do
this channel 22?
How many meetings? Oh, I had that written down.
Approximately. You do almost every...
Every meeting, yeah, and then it's over 200 a year. So with all the outside events and everything.
Right. So, I mean, so that people can immediately access it, get it streamed online.
Right.
People can see what the town government's doing, the transparency of the town government.
Exactly.
So, I mean, it's important stuff to get.
It is. It is. It's important to be updated. I mean, if it goes down, like that Anycast goes down, I mean, I could make it work, but not at that time. And it's an old machine, and it's been great, but it's old technology. It's like having a 10-year-old computer. It's the same thing. It's just it's gonna fail on you.
You had something else in your narrative that you didn't say?
About
chairs?
Oh, the chairs. Well, that's the next thing.
Oh, that's the next thing.
That's the next. Well, I mean, we could bring that up.
Let's do the first thing.
Yeah.
First.
Okay.
Regina, you have anything?
Yeah. So $11,400 just would just come out of the cable fund.
Yes, it would.
This.
Yes, it doesn't come.
Yeah, I agree. I think we need to run with the times here.
Okay. It would be 11 with the cables. If you, it would be 11,902. I was just brought that up to me today.
Oh. Yes, sir. And to expound on James' comments, this does meet the requirements of the purchasing policy for the town.
It does. Yep.
There's no exceptions.
Okay.
Thank you.
Rick?
Yeah, I'm also for it. I know you guys all work really hard there. And did you have any feeling on what we were talking about with the other people that were just here?
Oh, sure. Yeah. We have no problem with... working with John Justin. We've had actually a communication problem. I haven't been able to get a hold of him. I don't know what... You know, I text him, but he's not getting it. But no, John's a great guy, and he's our rep from the Channel 13. He's missed the last meeting. And I would just say he's going to come in and talk to me, and we'll get this straightened out. But as far as cooperation, sure. Why not?
Do you see any benefits from working with them and making this purchase that we're making? I mean,
well, it's all yeah. I mean, they have one of these. They have they got one last year. One of the switchers, the portable switchers. But I mean, they have one. So if we needed one, yeah, we could go get theirs. Or if theirs goes down, they can get ours. There's no need. You know, it's all one town.
Yeah, so. I'd like to make a motion to act on his request.
Okay.
I'll second it.
All right. I was just going to say...
Oh, sorry.
No, that's okay. That's all right. That last year we had a vote on the town meeting on the revenue stream for what this comes to. And the town overwhelmingly voted to give that money, to have it available so we could do this. So we could start building this system, replacing it and revamping it so we can come into the 21st century with
HD and
everything else. So Rick has made a motion to, I'll say, 11,902, so that he can include his $500 for cables.
Mm-hmm.
And Jim seconded it. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay, and the next thing was studio chairs and studio audience chairs. Now, the ones here you can see are from the 70s or something. I don't know where they're from, but I think we can attest that they're not that comfortable anymore. But
those were in the town office when it was in the old building.
Oh, okay. So they're old.
Yeah.
So, and I know it's kind of a gray area whether the cable committee should pay for those. You know, it's the studio, the Channel 22 studio in the selectman's room. Now, I just want to bring it up to you that if it's something that I think would be a good thing, if they're all uniform chairs, except for a few that I know some committees like to use certain chairs, but to change them and make them more comfortable chairs. And I gave you a list of chairs that for ranging from $40 to $100 a piece, depending on what you want to spend.
Now, these are just quotes from...
Those are quotes, yeah.
I think if we went out and we're going to order... These are just for buying single chairs at a place.
Right.
I'm sure we can get a better price.
We probably can.
If we're going to order 40 or 50 chairs,
yeah.
I think we can get a better price, too.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as the concept, I'm all in favor of you working up a price. We'll put a quote out.
Well, I think I just capped it at 5,000. That would be 50 chairs at the max, $100 a piece, which is more than enough for in here, plus a few spares.
So I think, you know, we need to put that out to bid.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's a good, I think it's something that well spent. This is our studio,
mm-hmm.
whether it's the selectman's room, this is used, as Jim just mentioned and you mentioned, there's 200 meetings here and we only have about 48 of them. So
right.
So there's right. many other organizations that use this room. It's the selectman's room, but it's actually our studio. So
I would say that before you order any chairs, make sure you sit in them.
Yeah.
I've I'll seen give it happen so many times before that we order the chairs and then they're awful when they get here.
Right.
Including, well, I won't say anything more.
I'm going to agree with Brian and Rusty, what you said, that it is a gray area, but it is the studio. Mm-hmm. It is part of the TV. Yeah.
The viewing experience.
So I do believe we can go with that. And I would make the motion that we approve going out and getting
the bids.
The bids and coming back with the bids and letting us know.
All right.
Do we need a motion on that or just a...
Made a motion, second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
All right.
So now that you've got, at least you know you can go out for the bids.
Right.
You know, you've got a rough idea what those prices are. We'll go out, we'll put it out to bid, and we'll see who it is, and then we'll bring it back and...
Okay.
That's all right.
It. Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good stuff. Next one is the town manager's report.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board. The window of opportunity for those to submit petitioned amendments to the zoning ordinance will close at 5 p.m. on December 14th. Amendments that will be filed by statute with the selectman's office. Petitioned warrant articles for any other subjects can be filed until 5 p.m. January 10th, 2017 in the Selectman's office. Please remember that there is no parking between the hours of 1 a.m. and 7 a.m. on any street in Hampton. With snow potentially in the forecast, hopefully not soon, in the somewhat near future, please remove your trash and recycling carts from the street and sidewalks so they won't be damaged by plowing operations. Carts that are damaged because they are not removed will be replaced at the owner's cost. Plow operators are reminded that plowing snow across a public highway is prohibited by town ordinance, also by state law. That's it, Mr. Chairman.
Any questions for the town manager? Sir?
No, thank you.
Bill?
Negative, sir.
Gina?
Nothing.
Old business? I see we have nothing on the old business. Does anybody have anything on the old business?
Yeah.
Correct.
I guess that there was more conversation at the planning board, and I think that we need to come out and decide exactly what our policy is here, because I've had a lot of people question me about it.
On? Trash?
The trash, yeah. I mean, I personally have felt differently, but there's at least four people on this board that made that policy. And I know that I was on the planning board, and they wanted a policy be made so that they could work with it. That's what we did. Now, what is the problem now at the planning board? Is there a problem?
My reading of the minutes indicates that they would like to consider picking up all the trash in town.
At all condominiums?
Yeah, it's nebulous. They didn't come right out and say that, but they were concerned that this policy should not continue and trash should be picked up on every condominium.
The planning board is, you know, are they trying to make the policy?
No.
The planning board was, there were some members of the planning board that said one thing and some that felt the other way. The planning board did say is that it's the selectmen's
your choice.
That they're the ones who are in charge of the trash and that they make the policy. The individual was there talking about redoing his documents. The planning board very clearly told him he has the right to do that. And then he has to go back to the selectmen, and the selectmen 99% will turn him down. But if he wants to do, there's no way they can stop him and say,
they felt there was no way they could say, no, you cannot go and have your, if you want to spend the money to do that, that's fine. But it, no matter whether the planning board supports it or doesn't support it, doesn't matter. It has to go to the select. The trash is in the hands of the selectmen, and it has to go back to the selectmen, and they most likely will turn you down.
I would say this in this argument, and if the basis of Mr. Welch's research, the condominium documents, is if it's in the condominium documents that they have agreed to that in the planning process and have been approved, then the town does not pick it up. Our conversation with Mr. Kelly last week, and I abstained, was that it's in his condo docs. He had the gray ambivalence area thing going on, trying to build an $8 million project. We get that. Now, if it goes back, this is a different horse. It's removed from the condominium documents, as we perhaps led to that belief in the discussion. It's not in the condominium documents. That doesn't even go, in my mind, to the selectman's policy. It's not in the documents, which is the basis why we're not picking it up now. We pick it up. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it, and that's my interpretation.
Wait a minute. I don't understand what you mean.
I do.
No. you're saying that we would pick it up if...
Well, that's been the basis why we're not picking it up. It's in the condo docs. It's a condition of the approval in the building. And that is the sole basis that we don't pick it up. Is that correct?
Up until the recent amendment... which spoke to new condominiums that were basically conversions of existing buildings that were built directly on the sidewalk so that you just wheel the carts out and leave them there.
But five or less.
Five or less.
Because at one time, it was there wasn't a five or less.
Right.
And I was all for that. But there is another situation. I mean, how many foot frontage does he have there? Is it about 50 feet?
Well, no, it's actually more than that.
I mean, what would it be, 150 feet?
150, 200 feet.
Yeah. And how far do the carts have to be by our statute?
The carts should be between 2.5 and 3 feet apart.
So
in
it's
order for the
each?
Piece of equipment to go in and pick a surface. Mm-hmm. Circle a cart, pick it up, and dump it in the back of the truck.
And the fact is there's 26 carts there. I mean, there's 26 units there.
Yeah, which is,
52.
You know,
52 carts.
So 52 carts. You couldn't possibly put them there under those, you know, for that amount. Plus, who wants to look at 52 carts? But
plus, do we have 52 carts?
And the other thing is,
and he's willing to take only 10 carts. But I mean, how can we? I don't see how we can.
I think we've already discussed this back this spring. And we came up with the rule or our policy that it was going to be five or less. I think if we don't stick to that, we go down, start going down a slippery slope of picking and cherry picking one or another. We're going to either have to do one or all of them.
And why we did that is because of the planning board wanted a firm policy.
But it's also not only that; it's also because of if we start adding every condo project. And every condo project has 25 or 30 barrels. And I don't know if the public works directors in the audience right now can tell us how long it takes to pick up each barrel and how much each barrel holds. We're going to have to buy, I'm going to say we're going to have at least two more trucks or three to pick up condo projects with barrels. And then we're going to have 4 to 6 employees more. So if the townspeople want us to pick up condos, then I think the only logical way to do that is have it a warrant article with a cost associated to that, because we got to know that the cost is going to be increased for picking up that many more barrels, and the cost associated with that is going to be also the cost of having those trucks, hauling it, disposing of it, maintenance on the trucks, everything else. So I think we need if the town wants to do that, then I think it's going to have to be a warrant article. So that we can have the whole cost in there.
And it will be for everybody, not just one
right.
place.
Right, we can't cherry pick and just do one.
And that's why I'm wondering, is it possible for us to take a vote to reaffirm the policy?
It's always possible for the board to do that.
I'll make that motion that
don't we already
reaffirm
have?
It. Well, I'd like to reaffirm it. I've been slaughtered with people
I'll
about
second.
This question
I'll
this week, and I'm sick
motion.
Of it.
All right, are we debating it right now?
Go ahead.
All right, there's still the issue. The cost, right. But there's still the issue that a person in a condo is paying exactly the same taxes as a person not in a condo. And they don't say that your taxes are less because, and I know you can argue that, but that's the argument that he had, and that's the argument that people in condos had that lived there, that you can say it's too expensive to do, which is fine. That's true. I agree 100% with that. But their argument coming back is, I am paying taxes the same as you are paying taxes and not getting the same services that you get. So I agree that if it's in the docks, that's one thing. But if it's not in the docks...
But it's in the docks because that's when it goes to the planning board. Now, if they want to change their docks, then they have to go reapply for that whole planning board. They can't just write it out of their docks and say, oh, it's out of the docks.
Right, right. No, they were told that. Yeah. They were told that.
They can't do that.
And Warren was... He was told that.
My issue is that there's not one other town that takes... I mean, we have a very liberal policy as it is with the five. There aren't any towns that take pickup condos. If you know of one, please let me know.
No, I agree with you.
There are none.
No, I agree with you 100%. But we passed the Warren article saying we were going to pick up trash.
We will continue to pick up.
Continue to pick up trash. All right, so we passed.
Not changing our past position. We continue to pick up the trash as we
Nothing about okay. condos. Except these five, possibly. I'm not sure that was in there.
Wasn't in there, was it?
No.
No.
You know, so
but we're saying it, there is an argument.
I know, but you, that's...
an argument.
This is something every board has faced this every time since I've been here, all 13 years, and it just doesn't fly that anybody wants to change this condo thing. And, I mean, I think that really that you... You know, that's why I think we should reaffirm what our policy is so we know what it is.
Well, we have
a first, we have a second.
Yep, there's a motion to reaffirm that policy. And I agree with the policy that anything under five, we will do so long as they can bring them out to the street. But anything over that, they have to pick up. Yes, sir.
Just want to qualify it because we've been going through all the condo doc files that are in the record. Okay? We have a lot of condominiums with two people, two units. That have to take care of their own. Now, the only way to change that, and no motion you make because of the Constitution in this state can be retrospective. That is to say, you can't go back in time and change something. It goes forward from that point in time forward. And you can't change what's filed in the Registry of Deeds for these condo documents. So if we have, and I think Campbell Drive's a wonderful example. Basically, one side of the street, you have both sides of the street, you have condexes, two condos together in a single building. One side of the street we pick up, the other side of the street we don't.
Oh.
Because of the way the condominium documents were originally written. One side of the street was by individual developers, one side of the street was by one developer. We have a lot of those. Now, I guess the question is, those are legally binding because of the way the planning board did this. They made them a condition of approval. And the only way to change that and the only way to actually pick those up is to actually have each one of those individual condominiums go back to the planning board and file their condominium documents all over again, start from scratch, as if they never existed, to take that item out. They have to go to public hearing. All the abutters have to be notified. There have to be all kinds of different things. The amendment has to be approved by town council. It's got to go to the attorney general's office for approval. It's a long, drawn-out process and extremely expensive. I just want to caution the board that we shouldn't be changing the way the condominium documents run because it's less than five. If it's currently required, we should be doing what's required in the condominium documents or eliminate them all. One way or the other, you got to have it. It's either what's recorded in the registry or it's not, and it's currently recorded. I don't think we should get into that slippery slope.
Then what you're saying is that the less than five doesn't hold water.
It holds water from the date you made that amendment.
Right.
You Forward. Made that vote. You can't. It's like saying, okay, we're going to retrospectively change your assessment on your house.
Yep.
You can't do it. It's against the law. The Constitution forbids it. So. We can't make a rule that goes back in time. You can make it from that point on, and that's exactly what you've done.
Yeah. Well, we did, before that rule was made, we did pick up others.
We so. Pick up every condominium. Well, there are lots of condos we pick up. Some of them have as many as 20 and 30 carts. because the planning board never put the restriction requirement on. It depended on where it is and when it was done. And some of these go back into the 1970s, early 80s. There aren't many of them, but there are some. And we have to pick those up because there's no requirement in the condominium documents not to pick them up, and we do pick them up.
But now we require that.
Well, the planning board has required it to be in the condominium documents at this point. They don't have to require that. But the statute says, as the town shall provide, that's 149, I think it's L, if I'm correct. And my town council's back there with his thumb up in the air. But the statute provides is the town shall provide a place for people to deposit their solid waste. We don't have to have a transfer station. We don't have to collect trash. We have to provide a place for people to take it. And we have to do that by contractual obligation of some sort. So we do something much more extensive than that, a lot more than a lot of towns do. You know, some towns pick up trash and residential only, no condos. Some towns pick up trash, no commercial. But we're one of the most advanced towns that picks up virtually everybody except for certain condominiums. And I remind you, some of those condominiums have roll-off boxes. Some of them have 20 and 30-yard boxes. Those require particular pieces of equipment to, in fact, get that trash out. So,
again, so the motion we have is to reaffirm the vote that we took back in...
A few months ago.
From that date forward is what it states, basically.
It's currently on the record that way.
Okay.
I need to ask a parliamentary procedure.
Sure, go ahead.
I hope somebody can answer it. If I voted in the affirmative before, can I change my vote?
We don't operate under Robert's Rules of Order, so there is no parliamentary procedure.
Okay, so I can do whatever I want.
Yeah, you got it. All those in favor? Opposed? Abstained? 3-1-1
Anything else under old business?
Yeah, I wanted to wrap here, Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
We're doing some stuff in Concord. We have talked about legislative efforts. There are bills that are either currently in the mix right now. We're looking for co-sponsors, whether one rep from this town or senator from this district is sponsoring or not. But 1198 is the repeal. 7274, it's in accordance with the legislative agenda with the New Hampshire Municipal Association. We heard the school district in here tonight, $26 million. We're looking at warrant articles. We're looking at $3 million for this, $1 million for that, pipes, roads, sidewalks. And the agenda up there for leadership from one party is that they are not for new taxes, but by giving away money under these three simple laws. Mr. Chinker, prior and again tonight, it's about $1.5 million in the last 3 years. They have devalued our revenue stream to this town, which is essentially a 5% tax on an annual operating budget. Those issues are going forward. There's a bill that's been introduced up there with the Legislative Services Office this week to take a look at the Hampton Beach State Parks. There is a on the DRED website, Guiding Principle for Leases. There are a plethora and myriad challenges that confront this town, to include perhaps up to $2 million a year in infrastructure operating costs and depreciation costs associated with performing duties on state property. That's a small strip. It's a small boundary. It's a small pizza box. We can easily handle it. Again, this is on the website. It is a precedent. We'll be exploring that. There is precedent. The public should look and look at Okemo's operating lease for an entire mountain called Mount Sunapee. That is state property. It is leased, staggeringly, surprisingly, for the amount of $150,000 a year, with 3% of the net, or the VIG, if you will. It costs $12,000 for a single-room efficiency apartment in the town of Hampton. Folks up in Concord have leased out that whole mountain that is owned by Okemo of Vermont Corporation. It owns Crested Butte, owns Okemo, and, of course, now runs Sunapee. So there's precedent. The Hampton Village District will have some input on that. That is a tremendous revenue opportunity. The parking system down there is not operated properly. The parking lot closes at 8 o'clock at night. There are myriad opportunities for that precious, precious real estate 12 months a year that is unexploited, undiscovered, and abused in the current situation. And the town of Hampton, with its tremendous, tremendous business and governmental affairs capabilities, could easily turn a profit much greater than what the state does, address revenue streams that would come directly to us, and would mirror something much more lucrative to the state than the current precedent they have with Okemah. So the game is on. We're looking for our money in Concord. We'll do that civilly. We'll do that articulately. We'll do it forcefully. And we've got four or five in just from one legislator. There's four or five more going in. We'll use the command element here as required in accordance with the will of the people during the last election, the approval of the Board of Selectmen, and as time allows. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Anything else in the old business? New business. First thing we have is the Selectmen's policy on the right to know procedure.
I'll let council go first.
Okay. The recent municipal conference has brought to light that there have been some recent rulings by the New Hampshire Supreme Court and by the Rockingham County Superior Court concerning the right to know law and electronic records. And as the right to know law proceeds with new technologies available, it does make sense, I believe, and Fred and Christine, in my absence, have worked very diligently on this right-to-know request procedure. There are some municipalities that have a procedure online where people can register, and then it seems to go into a black hole for a few days. This is a lot more direct. This procedure calls for a uniform, equitable procedure where people direct their requests to one place. That would be the Selectman's office, and then the Selectman's office can direct to the appropriate department to respond to the inquiry. This sets forth procedures that I believe are in line with the right to know law itself. It also addresses a procedure that's been approved by the Rockingham County Superior Court, hasn't yet gone to the Supreme Court, but in a very comprehensive opinion by one of the newer judges who's writes very well, requiring when you have electronic format records that those be generated not online, not answered online, but answered through a thumb drive at town cost that would be provided. And so this is for discussion. I've read through this, and I believe you have some upon my return, and I believe you have a few small edits that I have for this.
Fred, you have anything you want
to? The Superior Court recently had a case, the Rockingham County Superior Court, which is oversees everything in the county, including us. There have been a number of instances where people have come in and used electronic medium. They would, and some of the towns now have enacted regulations that say, we will provide you at our cost a thumb drive to download information. And the reason for that is simply because if you bring a thumb drive in and it's contaminated, you plug it into our system, guess who gets the contamination? We do. So we want to make sure the system is sanitized and continues to be sanitized instead of having some inadvertent error occur. So we wouldn't charge anything for that except what we have to pay. And we would download that information onto that drive and you walk away with it. It's much more effective and efficient, and people don't have to wait as long to find information. We can do that. We can do it very well.
Any questions? Regina.
So we would give them a thumb drive at our own cost?
At our cost.
Okay, and that will just alleviate any...
It can't be. There'd be a sealed thumb drive. It would be, in a sealed package, be taken out, and the information would be placed on the thumb drive and given to them at that cost.
Okay. So the cost for the thumb drive.
They pay for the thumb drive.
They pay for the thumb drive.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Absolutely.
They have the choice of bringing in one that's still in a new sealed container. Okay. They don't have to use ours.
All right. No, I don't have any questions. Thank you.
Negative, sir. I think it's a good idea in this age and time where somebody brings a thumb drive in that does have something that can affect our computer system. I think this is a great policy. It's not done for or against anybody, one group. It's just the policy on requesting the right to know policy.
Yeah.
And it's already been in the courts. The lower courts have approved it. And I think it's a good way to go.
So. And we put the charges in here, the court approved, which is 50 cents per page. That's what the police department charges now. So we didn't change any of that. We took it right out of the court record.
I agree 100%. And I agree with the thumb drive because, when you start communicating electronically or something,
you got to be careful.
Open to viruses and all that. I just want to make sure that according to this policy, it's available to the people. People can get the records that they request if it's appropriate. And they can pay the 50 cents, and the 50 cents is not exorbitant. I mean, it we're paying for everything that's making the copy.
So, right.
I agree 100% too. As long as it's been checked and rechecked and rechecked.
It does count. I don't know if this is the amended version or not, Mark.
One has revised it.
Yeah, so,
I just want to make sure I was signing the right piece of paper.
This one here.
He's looking for something very specific.
Yeah, that's there.
Okay. All right.
Okay. Yes.
This is the one. Okay.
Okay.
I'm sure it's boss. So if you vote this, I will pass that around and you can sign it.
So I need a motion?
I make the motion.
Second. By Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous.
All right. I'll start that around.
Next one is purchasing policy waivers. One is for salt for the 2016-2017 winter season. And permission to tack it onto the state bid.
Permission to tack us onto the state
bid. Tack us onto the state. Okay, so you want to do all these at once?
You can if you want to.
Yeah, why don't we do it once? I need a motion for that.
I'll make the motion.
Can we just briefly explain it, Mr. Welch, and then frame the motion, please?
Why don't we get our public works director up here so that having the assistant director, so they're both here. We might as well use them both. So.
Same price as last year. No change.
State bids this out collectively annually, and towns are invited to participate in the bid process, provided their Board of Selectmen votes to do so. That's the statute.
Yes.
We're asking you to affirm that vote, to use the state bid price, which is, you're not going to get that money for it. And if you have a question about that, then I'll refer it to the Public Works Director who actually did it.
That's why we're asking for a waiver.
No, actually, because we're using a state bid. There's a requirement within the purchasing policy. The board must approve that specifically.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. The next one is sodium hypochlorite.
Chemical used by the plant.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
But did we send it out to more than three?
It went out to 6 companies shy of the 10, only because there's not everybody that can feasibly and economically do it. We received one bid.
Okay, so I have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous. The next one is sodium
bisulfate.
Bisulfate, okay.
Again, used in the wastewater treatment plant. It went out to 9 different vendors. We did receive 3 bids, so it does not need a waiver, but asking for approval.
It is more than $50,000, so it requires board approval.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. The next one is contracted electrical services.
Contracted electrical services went out to 8 different companies. We received 2 bids. So it needs a waiver as we did not receive the third.
It's a multi-year bid, too.
And it is a multi-year contract.
So moved.
So moved. Seconded. All those in favor? Unanimous.
And there's nothing wrong with the multi-year contract? I mean, there was a...
No, nothing wrong with doing multi-year contracts.
Okay.
Spot herbicide.
Doesn't need your approval.
Spot herbicide. This went out to 10 different vendors. One of them did come back undeliverable, but we did only receive 1 bid. This is also a multi-year contract.
So moved.
Moved, seconded by Jim. All those in favor? Unanimous. Next one is line striping and pavement markings.
Great. This one went out to 10 vendors, and 2 vendors replied. This is also a multi-year contract.
Make a motion.
By Jim, seconded by Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous. And the next one is snow plowing, less than 3 bids.
I received a memo. It's not going to snow this year, but in the event that it does, this went out to 10 contractors as well. We received 1 bid. This is not a multi-year contract.
I believe Mr. Bean's filing a bill to that effect. There'll be no snow this year.
So you didn't get any bids but 1?
1 bid.
It's the same bidder that we've received in the last 2 years also. So we have, is there a motion?
Motion.
Motion by Jim, seconded by Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay.
And again, we look at why we only get...
Well, in the case of the snow would be, it's the commitment of the equipment. And we're up against all the Hannafords, Shaws, and the malls.
In the state.
Yeah, in the state. And then one of the reasons is, like, for instance, if you had a contract with Hannaford, you get $50,000 this year whether it snows or not, because you're parking equipment there 24/7, and you're making sure that it runs. And secondly, you literally contract with people a base pay whether it snows or not. So they pay, and therefore... We only have $1,000 that we give out. So we just don't rise to that level of, and therefore we don't get a lot of bidders of this caliber that we need.
A lot of the contracts, like you said, on the big businesses are done by the season, and you pay for the whole season.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. We're not looking for that. We're looking for per storm. And so
the other good thing with this vendor that we've had, remember 2 years ago during the ice storm, snowstorm, when we got the 33 followed by the 33, he was also the same contractor that was able to pick up the phone and line up 12 triaxle trucks that were not committed to other things, and was also able to bring 5 payloaders and an excavator to the town at our request to the town. So performance of this one particular vendor is proved to be good and qualified in our experience.
Okay. So we voted on that.
Okay.
We're all set.
I think you got 2 or 3 more items here that probably concern public works. Four-way stop signs.
All right. So why don't we... We have a request for a 4-way stop sign on Acadia Ave, and Thorwald, and speed bumps.
Are they 2 separate issues or 1?
They can't be 2 separate issues.
I move that we put a 4-way stop sign at the subject location.
I'll second that, but I'd like to open it for discussion.
I would too.
Okay, since I made the motion, I'll start the discussion. I know the territory very well. It's dangerous. There's been accidents. This young couple has testified to it. They provided good documentation for it. It doesn't hurt to put up another 2 stop signs. People should slow down there. There are a lot of children. It's congested. It's highly urbanized. It's dense.
and there's a lot of summer traffic in there. There's a lot of people walking kids. They're walking down on the beach, and it's a very dangerous spot. The young lady did a magnificent job in articulating the dangers there. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Jim?
Do you have any thoughts on this?
At that location, I think it's warranted because it's dense in the amount of housing, but also there isn't a huge approach lane up to the stop sign. You know, like, for instance, if you're coming down Mill towards you kind of realize, hey, this car's passing in front, it's open enough. That same situation does not exist in this neighborhood. And I think that obviously the four stop signs, all the residents in that area would realize it, and then it would be a safety improvement. I'm not opposed to it.
I just disagree with the stop signs being this way to solve it, because we have the stop signs farther down the road and no one stops at them. Mm-hmm. So I think the actual speed bump would be required to actually slow people down, because the culprits are people that live there. I've seen them. I see them every day. And I don't think that the stop signs are going to... I think they'll definitely help 100%. I think they should be put there. But I think another step needs to be done with people on Arcadia coming up from the top of Arcadia. Then you have Walnut, Emerald, Thorwald. There's nothing on Emerald. Is there a stop sign Walnut in Arcadia?
Yes.
Yes? Okay. But there's nothing on Emerald, so you have not only people coming down Arcadia, people coming off Emerald. And if there was something in between, like maybe 50 Arcadia up until the intersection, that would slow people down. And that's where a lot of the visitors come from that aren't even familiar with the area.
Now, are we doing this as one? I thought we were doing it as one for the street signs first.
We're doing it as street signs first, and then we took it as two separate issues.
All right.
Because I think... And I have no problem with putting another sign there. I grew up in that area. I'm in that area all the time. It is, and like you said, it's probably more than not people that live in that area, because there isn't very much daily traffic that goes through there unless you're going in and out of that area for a specific purpose. So I for one, don't have a problem with the stop sign. Before we start putting any speed bumps and stuff in, I would like it to that before to go to the police department and the police chief, as we've done with other problems in this town and other parking issues.
Should we vote on the stop signs first?
We brought it up to discussion, so we were discussing it first.
So we can
have the vote on that now,
and then do the speed bumps afterwards.
We have a motion and a second for the four-way stop sign. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Now I'll make a motion for the speed bump to open up for discussion.
Second.
All right. Okay. Go ahead.
Speed bump's going to have to be taken up in the winter, right?
Right. Yes.
So it's... I agree with Rusty that we should discuss it with the police, or they should discuss it with the police, and it should go through that before we go to the speed bump.
That's my thing. I mean, we have 5 months right now before we could put one down anyways. Mm-hmm. Right. So in that time, why don't we, we will forward Sarah? Yeah. We'll forward Sarah's name onto the police chief and have him get in contact with you, as he's done in other neighborhoods that have had parking issues and speed issues and stuff like that. And that seemed to have worked very well. And so I think that would be the way to go is have them.
It would be our department's recommendation to do so with the concurrence of the police department. So whatever their traffic and speed study tells us, and you vote, that's what we would do.
I think this is something that we need to leave in control of the police department.
So
shouldn't be up
so
to
we
us.
Have a motion. What was your motion, to just bring it up or to accept it?
So now you're going to rescind the motion.
I'll rescind the motion.
Okay, so we're going to rescind that motion, Sarah, but I suggest that I will forward this to the police chief, and if he doesn't get in contact with you within a week or so, make sure that you give him a call, because that's worked out really well. We had some parking issues up and some speed issues up on Boar's Head. We've also had some Moore Ave and other streets in town, and it seemed to have worked out very well. So.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. We are doing the stop signs, right?
We are going to do the stop signs. Yes, yeah. We just voted that, and the stop signs will be for a four-way stop.
Thank you.
Okay. Extend the school speed limit sign on Winnicunnet Road. And I believe if we go back and look at that, the gentleman talks about the speed limit by the My First School and the school, Academy Ave, and stuff like that. And he did mention in there how they used to have the blinking light in front of the fire station that was taken down when they did the renovations and was never put back up. That blinking light was to, it would turn red when the fire trucks came out when they hit the button. But it also gave warning to people that were traveling up and down that road. So his suggestion was to extend the school 20-mile-an-hour speed limit from where it is now on headed east on Winnicunnet Road before the school to down about to Mr. Bean's house across from the fire station so that it would slow people down that area where we have a lot of kids crossing there. We have churches in that area. We have, and it's just going to reflect more in the schools. So what's everybody's thought?
I say that when you wrap around Winnicunnet, it's 20 miles right past the cemetery. Upwards of 7,000-8,000 cars a day travel on that. Many of them are youngsters, newly licensed. We notice in the morning, of course, the huge amount of parents that drop their kids off. And I would extend that to wrap around right until where the Winnicunnet 20-mile-an-hour ends on the southeast side, if you will.
Good point.
Thank you.
Good point.
Yeah, because we have that light there. That
light for them, right? But there, that light also has what? Does it say end? Or no, it doesn't. There may be a sign that says end, but we can move that back up to here. So
we put that there for the same reason.
The school put it there. We didn't put it there.
No, we did. I made the motion when we did it.
Oh,
definitely.
Okay.
So if someone could frame that motion and wrap that all the way around to the southeast.
The motion will be to extend the school zone from before Center School headed eastbound to
almost to Landing Road
to Winnicunnet end of school zone at Winnicunnet.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
We should arrange to put flashing lights out there.
We should.
And that's what we did with that other one. And Ginny was on the board when I made that motion.
Yeah. And it really needs to, those lights need to be there. I mean, I came in at 6:30 in the morning usually. And it's not unusual when I come down Winnicunnet Road to actually have people pull out and pass me. And I'm doing the speed limit. So it's the morning out here is treacherous, particularly if young children trying to cross the street. Before the crossing guard gets
if
here.
If we are making that whole area that limit, could we take the one that's already there and move it up to here?
My suggestion is we put an additional one here, perhaps one of those battery operator or solar operator ones, which are fairly inexpensive because we don't have to connect to the power lines and so on and so forth. They're battery solar powered.
Yep.
We put one up here and just let that run the whole. In fact, we need another one down just as you come off of Mill Road. Coming this direction. Coming.
I agree.
At least two more. I would recommend we leave the one that's east of Park Ave, just to remind the people who are using still Park Ave.
Yeah. That actually belongs. The school paid for it.
Okay.
As part of the installation for the school, so it actually belongs to them. So I don't want to move those. They maintain them. They take care of them. They set them. They change the times and so forth. So,
okay.
And they pay the bills on them. So I don't want to. Get involved with that. So if we put two new ones out here, I think that'll solve the problem so that we actually have good continuity.
We get a price on that?
Yes.
On two more lights?
Yeah.
And similar to the solar ones like these, the crosswalk lights are?
We will try. Yeah.
Are we talking 24/7 or are we talking during school
during
hours?
During school hours.
During school hours.
We put a timer on it. It would have to be programmable for the day of the week and the time.
Just so that we're clear, it's during school hours.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, so the next thing is request for the removal of all the pine trees on Academy Ave.
We received a letter, Mr. Chairman. To the best of my knowledge, it's been mentioned to me several times that those trees are actually planted out there as memorial trees.
I don't know for who or for what, but she's done some digging.
I took some pictures.
Good job.
That's as much as I got to do.
Okay. Thank you. As far as we know, the trees are completely healthy.
I would just say this, Mr. Chairman, that those are beautiful trees, and you and I went to junior high school there. We know those trees well, and they perhaps know us, but they're beautiful trees, and I don't support any motion to cut down any of them unless they're diseased or they are a safety hazard.
Yeah, they're not really in the wiry area either.
No.
Across the street from the wires.
Yeah. If they, you know, I agree. If they're not a safety issue and they're not diseased, I don't think we should be taking them down.
I think it adds to the...
It's beautiful.
The request from from particularly one of the residents on Academy has been that the branches fall down. And in response to that in the past, a little more than 5 years ago, under Frank's direction, they did de-limb them up a significant distance. Do we get called for some branches? Yes. Maybe once or twice a season. And earlier this year, we got called for a bee infestation on one of them. Other than that, you're right. My reservation as the tree warden is that, given the age of the trees, they were probably tied to a bicentennial or something like that. And I'm hesitant to take them down.
And we've actually, the one next to the library, we actually had UNH come out here and do a bore test on it to determine whether it was red-hatted, and it is not. It's a huge tree, but it's not red-hatted. So there's no reason to take the tree down. I know that Public Works does watch the trees, and when there are dead limbs on them, they have them removed.
Yep.
So
I have the arborist with me next week, first full week of December, to look at suggesting trees to replant in the various parks to replace some of the trees that we took down. I can have them also give me an opinion or a look at these particular trees. And we would continue to do it year after year.
So
that would be reasonable.
Absent of anybody, any motions, we'll continue on.
Well said.
Okay. Next is discussion of draft warrant articles. And they are just that, drafts.
Oh, you wanted to come on?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. I can stand
that. No. There, it can be yours.
And
discussion and not has to do with.
While we have...
Mr. Chairman, if... Am I, if the board is inclined, Fred, did you get into the tally vote at all?
Not yet. I did discuss it with the chairman before we started, but go ahead.
Okay.
You're on a roll.
Very good. Mr. Chairman, in the past, when the board has taken up the discussion of warrant articles, there are times where the board chooses to act on those and then to release them for Budget Committee and public consumption. But in connection with taking any votes, there is the opportunity to vote, as the board has done in the past few years, to record not only the board's recommendations, but also the tally votes. The town meeting has not voted to do this, but the selectmen have the ability on their own initiative to do so under two sections, RSA 32:5, Roman 5, -a, and also RSA 40:13, Roman 5, -a. So if the board chooses to keep tally votes, then as we go along through the articles tonight, then the board, we can keep track of those. And moreover, then the Budget Committee would do the same.
We need a motion for that?
Yes, sir.
So I'll make the motion.
Motion? Seconded?
And what is the motion?
The motion to do the tally vote.
Okay.
Second?
Now, that's what we've done in the past, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, we have.
But it doesn't carry over 1 year to the next.
So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Now, I'm just going to suggest that I see Public Works has a lot of them in here, and I see our librarian out in the back room, and she has just one warrant article that she has got a draft on. So we'll take that one up really quick, and that way there she can get out. I'm sure she had a long day already. And
that's very kind. Thank you. Thank you, guys.
No problem. And I'll read it. It'll say to add windows to the children's library, children's room at the library.
What number is that?
Number 37. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $43,525 for the purpose of adding three new windows to the children's room at the Lane Memorial Library? This shall be a non-lapsing appropriation per RSA 3276 and will not lapse until the purpose of said article is completed or by March 31st, 2019, whichever is sooner. Majority vote required. Would you just like to speak on it really quick so that we can have some information?
Absolutely. I will say, just preamble to all of this, I started in 2008. The question was, are we going to be this place where we build a new library, we're going to stick in the library we have? Very early on, I said, we're sticking with the library we have. This building is phenomenal. It was given to the town for the purpose of being the library. Why would we abandon it when it has so much already going really well for it? With that said, the children's room is beautiful, but subterranean. And so you spend a little bit of time down there and you start to feel like you're trapped in a Walmart or a box store, something with no fresh air, no sunlight. The wall that actually, we share the parking lot, the wall that shares the parking lot with the town hall, is the wall that the children's room has. I say subterranean, it's one third above ground, two thirds below ground. And so we do have two small windows there, but the wall is partitioned in such a way that there are five spaces. Three of the spaces had HVAC equipment hanging from the ceiling, and two had the windows. When we did the HVAC work 2 years ago, we had that equipment all relocated, so it's no longer in the ceiling, giving us that option to open up those three spaces for windows in the future. Should this succeed, we'd have a continuous wall of light coming into the room. We'd be able to open up those windows. It's a minor element, but both of the exits for that room lead to the same direction within the building. If there was an emergency, we're anticipating these three windows would open wide enough for people to actually get out of with the assistance of a ladder or something like that, so that never going to happen. But if there was some major catastrophe, both of those exits in the children's room lead you to the same catastrophe if it's right there. And so this way you could be really fleeing away from those things. So that's a small element to those windows as well.
Any questions?
So moved.
Second.
I'm just going to, on discussion.
Yep.
I know it's a small amount of money, but we're going to have some huge amount of money in warrant articles this year. And I think we really ought to think whenever we're on money articles. I mean,
I've thought about it.
Okay. I agree 100%, but I just feel like we have to really be careful here.
I feel like it's not the right year.
That's what I feel like, because there's going to be so many of the big ones.
And it may be not the right year for some of the big ones, too.
And it might not be.
Sometimes you might get the little windows for the kids in the library.
Well, and I'm usually a believer that we leave it up to the voters. So.
Okay.
So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor? 4-1. One opposed? There you go.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So now,
I'm not prepared to talk about any other warrant articles.
I guess 12 is the one we start with.
If I could make one comment before we start, and it basically would build off of Selectman Waddell's question or comment. Years ago, in the prior director, he would look at all these things that we would come up with and decide which he felt two or three should come forth to the board. I disagree. I say we should uncover all manner of situations, and with the permission of the manager, develop warrant articles as he sees fit. Bring those forth to you. You would not disappoint Jennifer or I or other members of my staff if the majority of these did not go forward because of the large size of the tickets. As I've explained to them, some decisions have to be made collectively with us, with you, and you have the final say. So please don't feel obligated to approve one or over the other. To that effort, I have gone and put a prior at the suggestion of Jamie Sullivan and the town manager, Fred Welch, put down our rating system high, medium, low, and even we had to make some tough choices and had to have some talks internally about, well, how come my generator project isn't moving forward? And we understand that there is some tough choices that have to be made by not only this board, but also the voters. And that, so we leave it to your guidance and consideration as to which ones of these would go forward. Thank you.
Okay, so the first one we'll discuss is the number that we have it numbered at this time. Is Article 12, is the Church Street Force Main.
I might add that this is an estimated cost.
Mm-hmm.
This is not a final engineering cost. This is just an estimate by the engineers. Same with the following article.
Okay. Shall the town vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $3,100,000 for the purpose of constructing the necessary upgrades and replacements of two old undersized wastewater force mains between Church Street and the pumping station and the wastewater treatment plant. The first main is made of ductile iron. It was installed in 1987 and failed early in 2016. It was repaired. The second main is made up of asbestos concrete and installed in 1969. It is necessary to have both these force mains operating during the summer months to transport the normal sewage flow to the water treatment plant during the 6 months of the year to prevent a backup of overtopping the sewer system at Hampton Beach. The force mains are to be constructed along State Highway 101 from Church Street pumping station to the wastewater treatment plant, therefore ceasing the use of aged and unacceptable and inaccessible pipes that are located in the marsh. Such sum to be raised in the issuance of municipal bonds and notes for a period not to exceed 30 years under the accordance of the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen and the Town Treasurer to issue and negotiate such bonds or notes to determine the rate of interest thereon in accordance with the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for contract for and accept and expend any federal, state, or other available funds towards the project in accordance with the terms and conditions under which they are received, and to borrow in anticipation from the receipts of such funds and or the issuance of such bonds as notes as provided in the Municipal Finance Act, again RSA 33, and to authorize participation in the State Revolving Fund, SRF, RSA 486:14, established for the purpose to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply, accept, and expend such monies as they become available from the federal and state governments, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to implement cost-effective solutions present in the future and deemed to be in the best interest of the towns of the town, that they may result in a lesser amount of expenditure than authorized by the warrant article, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to take any actions necessary to carry out the project in the best interest of the towns. 3/5 vote required. That's a mouthful.
A couple of words.
Have any questions?
I would like to ask the director. Now, what do you think the estimate is going to be for the wall up at
Bicentennial?
Yes.
To approach $2 million.
Yeah. I myself see only one of these things that do I feel the board should get behind.
Shouldn't we just stick with the?
Let's stick.
Well, that's how I feel about it, so that's why I will not be voting for this.
Okay.
All right. I have a question.
Yep.
And I guess the importance of this is what I'm really would like you to describe. That is this something
that if we don't do it, the state's going to come in and say we have to do it anyways? I mean, what's the probability of that happening?
No, I have to honestly say I don't know, in that they have drafted an administrative order of consent, but the third word is the key part, the consent. They have language in there that basically says that if you don't fund it, they will.
They will fund it, or they will...
No, they will... Yeah, they'll write the check and bill you for it.
Okay, so they will not fund it.
Correct.
I want to make let's make that perfectly clear to people. Right. Yeah,
yeah, they'll pass you the bill along, and when they consider it an emergency, they don't necessarily choose low bidder; they choose who they can get to do it at the time. So, would they force us to do it? Let's say after March, if it doesn't come to a fruition funding-wise, that remains to be seen. All my indications with the state is they'd like to be a kinder and gentler state, but don't test us, is basically how the conversation has gone.
If it may ask another question?
Sure.
If it fails again, or if we had another leak, the probability of them saying, hey, go fix it again, or the probability of them saying, all right, now change it?
Well, two things would well, I'll answer your question first. They would probably then issue an administrative order, and it wouldn't be an AOC, wouldn't be with consent. It would just strictly be an administrative order. Because we're already on record of having an incident, a release of raw effluent. We're already on record as having, you know, had high fecal counts that went out into the harbor, that disrupted clam harvesting. In other words, we've had our due notice. So that the expectation is that not only from the state level, but the federal level, there would be consequences for not having addressed, because part of the law that's cited in the AOC reads, you can't knowingly avoid an issue that you know potentially is going to contaminate the environment. In other words, if you knew you had a crack in your gas storage tank, or you knew you had a crack in your dam wall, you can't ignore it. We've already had our crack. We fixed it. Replacement is the action that we need to take.
And he's asking him to answer a question that he doesn't know the answer, that he couldn't possibly know. And I'd like to know how many other towns have the state taken that heavy-handed action that you know of? None.
Record for three or four. I can't. What? They're on record for three or four, where they've cited corporations or contractors or municipalities for, once they were aware of it, failing to take action.
And we are on record for having taken action,
right. And
we are on record that we know what to do if it was to happen again, and it's not the worst calamity that we know it wouldn't cost that much. I think we have to take into consideration, and we are taking them one by one. But we have to look at, are we going to go for that seawall, if we're going to go up on Route 1? There's a lot of different things here. And they do have different values. That is something that is fixed for right now. We could come back. Everyone's talking about infrastructure aid and improvements. Maybe next year, after some of that stuff has been hashed out, it will be a better time. Because things that have to do with sewers and that certainly would be a top priority. I'm not so sure that, even though the schools should be, I'm not so sure they will be, but I bet you the sewers system will be.
Yeah, I felt that this rose to the level of a special town meeting.
last year. I think it's late in the game not to have answers. I think it's late in the game to be saying what would the state do. I think it's late in the game to be saying what a higher headquarters would do. This is the town of Hampton. There are billions and billions and billions of dollars of property down there. There are people that have their entire life savings. They're not public employees that get pensions from the government. They're people that have their capital at risk. There are banks that loan them money. And if you have high fecal count content down there, nobody cares what the state of New Hampshire says. Nobody cares what Rusty Bridle says. Nobody cares what Chris Jacobs says. Chris lives in Milton. Mark lives in Dover. Jen happens to live in this town. But the business community in this town will be paralyzed because we did not act. Hampton Beach, if it has a fecal issue in the July 4th weekend, will take a decade to recover because we don't do the right thing. This is my opinion. This is the most important warrant article on this table. Fire trucks, we can wait. We have mutual aid. There are issues to come up with that. The seawall is a very huge safety issue. We'll get into that tonight. This is the proximate result of people never investing in infrastructure. When we complied with GASB, it indicated, and we were told it was too expensive. Our finance director did a brilliant job. It cost us how much, Mr. Welch? Zero. Heard for years on this board, when I was a new member, it's going to cost too much money. When that GASB requirement comes down and it shows $2 million a year in depreciation, add that $2 million onto your operating costs, because that's what that figure represents. That is another expense no less real than payroll, pension costs, et cetera, et cetera. Rick makes good points. Jim makes good points. Mark makes good points. This is the most important issue on the warrant. I'm an enthusiastic supporter of it. Everybody knows that I felt that it rose to the level of a special meeting, special town meeting. It's pennies on the dollar. And if you look at one fecal issue, an effluent issue, if you will, to put it more appropriately, you look at two issues, it will never, ever recover. People will move elsewhere for their vacation. They will discover new places, and they won't come back. They just won't come back because they won't trust us. And so I enthusiastically support this. I think we tighten up, and what we hear tonight is an estimate. We tighten up on those numbers. We get the answers from the state, and we tell the state we're doing this. State of New Hampshire doesn't run Hampton. We run Hampton. State of New Hampshire doesn't run our infrastructure. We run that. We're the Board of Selectmen. We don't answer to anyone else, not the federal government, not the state government. We answer to the people of this town to protect them, to protect business owners and people that pay tens and tens of thousands of dollars and have their whole life tied to one summer, 12 weeks. And if we screw it up, shame on us. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Well, Janie, you got anything?
Yeah, I would like to 100% I agree with Phil Bean. I think this is the most important warrant article that there is on the town warrant this year. And I would like to ask you guys a question. When we fixed the pipe out on the marsh, what was the cost just to get out there and get to the pipe that is buried 7 feet under the marsh?
It was, I think it all came in at about 122 out of the 130 that we had set aside when all of a sudden done 122,000.
And this is just to get out and look at the pipe.
And I think what you have to understand is that it was $7,000 in material to fix it. Right. You do the math there, that's, you know, over $100,000 just to get there. And then
fix it, and then again, we don't have any way to ever know whether there's something wrong or maintain it because it costs $120,000 to get out there and look at it.
Yes.
So I think that the voters just need to be made aware that without these two wastewater pipes that we need both of for our summer season, which the town of Hampton survives on, lives on that summer season, that these pipes need to get into a place where our Public Works Department can get down there and get to them in an immediate fashion without having to spend hundreds of thousands of dollars to do so. So,
in reality, we also need at least one of them all year long.
Right. But, yeah, and you need them both to be in a place where they're accessible.
To be cleaned and maintained in the future.
And, yes, I believe that there will probably be funding available for this, hopefully sometime in the near future by our country. And I think that the warrant article needs to
be shown is how important it is to the voters this March, and hopefully it will get passed. You have my full support for
it. One thing maybe you can't answer, but maybe the council or the town manager can. If we go forward with this, we can bond this for 30 years or 20 years, whatever it is. If we don't and the pipe fails and the state orders us to fix it or they pay for it and then we have to pay them back, can we bond that? That
it'll,
payment?
It'll show up on your tax bill in one lump sum because they will set it at the time the tax rate is set. Now, if they're really nice, I hope they are, they'll give you the SRF. They'll let you bond it for 30 years and everything will go forward. It just depends. The entire administration down there is changing. There will be a new commissioner of DES. We have no idea what's going on. I can tell you that according to the AOC, which we haven't signed, they have a finite date at which point this is to be committed into action, which is October of 2017. So that's what's in the document. We haven't signed that. We're still talking to them about that. The town has to vote it. Special town meeting won't work. It's just the way that the state has the system set up that we actually put the mechanics together for the special town meeting, and it would have taken place 1 week before the annual town meeting. So it didn't make any sense to do it because it takes that long to get through all those approvals from the state and federal government and everybody else. So the annual town meeting is the only way to do this if you're going to do it. The state's idea is the state's idea. How they're going to accomplish that at the other end, we don't know. They have a myriad of choices to make. We're hoping they make the right choice. So if they order us, we hope that they give us the SRF funding, and we hope that, that they order the town to float a bond on the state authority, and we go from there. But they don't have to do that.
I could say I was out there when they found the pipe. Oh, I actually walked out on the marsh and walked out with them while they were out there doing it. And she's right, $7,000 to actually fix the pipe, $118,000 or $20,000 to get out to that pipe. There's no telling. We can't camera that pipe because it's too long. We can't clean that pipe because it's too long. There's no way of doing that unless you actually physically went out there again and opened up those pipes and went halfway across or did it in two places, a third either side. So there's no common way to do that. And so, yes, we could leave it the way it is, and we could all hold our breath, and it could not happen for 4 or 5 years, or it could happen tomorrow. We don't know that with that pipe, and we got no way of telling them. So, let's be, as Phil said, with the infrastructure we have down there, and the tax base we have down there, and the importance of those two pipes, I think now is the time to do that.
Mr. Chairman, you had asked for a comment on my end, and I would just say from a liability point of view, we were extremely lucky to have found this when it happened so that it could be fixed during the off-season and so that no one's business and no one's lives were negatively impacted at the time. Should this occur during a different season, we would not only have costs to repair to face, I am sure we'd be facing a lot of claims or other kinds of damages that I would rather not see us face. And certainly we want to avoid a health concern. We have one of the cleanest beaches in the country, one of the top-rated beaches, and Mr. Mean is right that that's a tremendous asset to us. And once that's blackened by something that we could have avoided, I think it would be shame on us.
So, we need to have a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Before you vote, I do, after the article was put together and we are at 60% plans, we have got the survey done, the borings done, wetlands analyzed, the actual price that I have from Wright Pierce is $3,207,000.
So moved.
Motion by Phil, seconded by Jim, to the Article 12 as written.
Is it my understanding that we're still on the basis that we're going to try to bid this out before town meeting so we have an actual cost?
Yes, we are proceeding.
Okay, so that's a tentative figure.
So the figure right now is?
Accurate but tentative.
$3,207,000.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Those opposed? 4-1. Okay, you guys want me to read this whole article too?
Want somebody else to read
it? Why don't you read this one?
Article 13, Lafayette Road Sewer. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $1,100,000 for the purpose of replacing the sewer main on Lafayette Road from its intersection with High Street to the intersection of Toll Avenue and Winnicunnet Road? The current main is composed of vitrified clay pipes, 10 and 12 inches in size, that were installed in 1934 and 1982 and are in failing condition. Various pieces are missing from the pipe, making it impossible to properly clean and inspect the pipe or to reline the pipe. Therefore, replacement is necessary before complete failure occurs. In the course of replacement, it will be necessary to excavate the eastern side of the highway that will require partial reconstruction of the roadway and patching and repairs to provide a uniform roadway. It will be necessary to reconstruct the entire roadway, as explained in a companion Warren article, and such sum to be raised by the issuance of municipal bonds or notes for a period not to exceed 30 years under in accordance of the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen and the Town Treasurer to issue and negotiate such bonds or notes and to determine the rate of interest thereon in accordance with the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for, contract for, accept, and expand any federal, state, or other available funds towards the project in accordance with the terms and conditions under which they are received, and to borrow in anticipation of the receipt of such funds and or issuance of such bonds or notes as provided in the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, and to authorize the participation state revolving fund SRF RSA 486:14 established for the purpose, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for, accept, and expend such monies as they become available from the federal and state government, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to implement such cost-effective solutions as are presented in the future that they deem to be in the best interest of the town that may result in a lesser amount of expenditure than is authorized by this warrant article, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to take any and all actions necessary to carry out the project in the best interest of the town of Hampton. 3/5 vote necessary. Note, final figures will be available at the completion of the engineering and or bidding.
Okay.
Yeah. I would just like to say this is a case where I do support it. The pipes are over 30 years older, and we know that there's something the matter with them. The other pipes, as far as I'm concerned, we don't know. But I would like to move this one.
Move it second, and then we'll have some conversation.
Yeah, I would just like to say that, again, as Mr. Bean said fairly clearly about the beach down there, this is talking about Uptown, and how many restaurants and businesses would be affected by this pipe?
This pipe goes all the way up to and past Old Salt. Up and around that area, across the street, back down to the Hagens, that end, and then come all the way down Route 1, everybody on both sides, all the way down to the intersection.
So, again, we're talking, if this failed, an absolute economic...
It's residential,
everything
commercial,
north of Dunkin'
everything.
Donuts would be out of business.
Okay.
Shut down. That's how critical the location is.
Again, I agree with Rick. We know it's broken. We know it's not working. It's amazing.
This has come up a number of times, and I can remember 5 or 6 years ago this came up, and they had cambered the lines in 1989, and the lines showed that they had failed. The pipe was failing in 1989, and they when the lines were cambered, they had found this stuff. It came up 5 or 6 years ago. And the suggestion by the board at that time was to camera the lines again and see if anything has changed. Nothing has changed.
A new pipe?
Nothing has changed. Matter of fact, I was down there, again, I get caught in all these situations, but we had effluent flowing down the street.
It was late April or early March when
Dunkin' Donuts, because the pipe had got clogged. And to find the clog, they couldn't send the camera down, and they couldn't send the jet down because they were afraid that if they sent the jet down, it would undermine the street, and then they'd have to, would be digging up the whole street then. They were able to get that clog out of the way, get it moved, and clean it out the best they could. But as Rick said, these pipes were put in, what's it say, 1934 and 1982. So these pipes have been in the ground a long time. This piece is missing. Just as important as those pipes are to the beach, this one is as important to our downtown area. Mm-hmm. And I think I think it's, again, it's due to not purposely neglecting it, but it's been left over time, and it just isn't getting any better. And to do nothing, then we are at fault at not maintaining our infrastructure.
And this is something that it's become, this, which is different than the one at the beach, we have been told over and over and over again about it. Yep. I've heard it sitting on this board at least four times that we've known that it's damaged and it wasn't fixed.
An important notion to put forward, Mr. Chairman, is that interest rates are very, very low. So that is an opportune time. Additionally, the valuation has increased. So there will be softening blows by both of those phenomena to this project. And parts of this pipe literally have no top. And it has been abject neglect by leadership. There have been some tough economic times since 2008. Nobody wants to spend money if they don't have to. But this is long overdue, and it has been abject neglect. Somebody has to step up exercise some mature leadership, and the voters and the people that do live in this town, that do frequent and patronize these businesses, will support it, and I'm for it. Thank you.
So I'd like to say that this pipe to me is just as important as the two that we have under the marsh. Those are our three lifelines, I want to say, of what the town, how the town exists. Without those, to me, nothing else matters, so I'm in full support of this warrant article as well.
So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous. You want to read the next one, Jim?
Sure.
I want somebody else to.
No, I don't mind. Replace Bicentennial Park seawall. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $1 million for the purpose of replacing the seawall at Bicentennial Park? Such sum to be raised by the issuance of municipal bond. Do we need to go through that whole part?
It's all the same as the one you just
It's read. All the same. Ditto on the last one, that part.
Three-fifths vote required.
Three-fifths that vote required.
Final estimates will be done after the engineer's estimates are bidding. So, somebody want to make a motion, and then we'll second for discussion?
I think the director said that the figure he currently has is closer to $2 million.
And I do want to just say that they are diligent in putting that together. We had a meeting with them the Friday before Thanksgiving when we all circulated the information that we sent to you. They presented us some options, you know, that we need to review with the board. Obviously, all options have costs associated with them, but that is the approximate value to repair / replace the wall.
And what is the importance
of the replacing the wall? Basically, the investigation that we did in this past year, per the Warren article last year, that allowed us to look into the actual concrete material itself, how the wall is embedded into the earth, and what's actually happening currently with the wall. The results have come back, not good. The concrete wall is composed of two layers, if you want to call it, the original wall, and then a wall that was built over it when the Coast Guard was there. The inner wall is showing signs, the concrete's been tested to have the silica reaction, which means it's expanding, which means it's crumbling. Although the outer surface doesn't have it, that's great, but if the inner part is falling out, the outer part's going to have nothing to attach to. The wall is not embedded as one would have hoped, imagined, liked. In some cases, it's not even embedded 2 feet underneath the lower level of the wall.
So what level of importance have you attached to it? I mean, I read the report.
We are here, and this is important. I'd say on our list, it just went to high.
It's similar to the question before, what will happen with the state. Will, so you could put the same probability question to this wall. Will this wall fail, or will it will stay together? If we have a mild winter like we had last year, status quo. We will not lose the wall. It won't fall in. If we have a major nor'east storm with a lot of wave action pounding the wall, could it undermine it and allow more water in, or a lot of flooding and erosion? Yes, it could. What Jen was alluding to when we say it's not pinned is, remember the rest of the seawall when the state put it in, say in the 60s or 70s, they drove the metal sheet piling in all the way down the ledge. And then, of course, a cap got put on that, concrete cap. And then later, that whole thing got entombed with what we more see now. So, in other words, that the rest of the state's seawall is actually tied to the sheet piling that went all the way down to the ledge. Ours literally sits on sand. So one of the worst things could happen for it is a lot of overtopping. That would create turbulence on the backside, erode that sand, and literally undermine the wall from the backside. That's its real weakest point, and it'll actually fail getting pushed in. So they've recommended, our engineers have recommended us, we look at putting in more stone than we normally do, and that we be prepared to put in more stone if we see a bigger storm on the horizon. And that's where we're moving, in that direction, talking to contractors, obtaining costs. So, yes, this is one of those hard decisions that, and I didn't have a price when we put our list together. What do you choose? Do you choose a seawall? Do you choose a, It is a very, very tough choice.
When you talk about options and you talk about putting more stones or more boulders down there and stuff, would that be a temporary solution?
Yes. Part of it, and actually a solution to the future. Because if you look at the aerial photos now, you can see that we don't have half of the stone out in front of our wall to diffuse any of the wave action.
Right.
So one of the options that we're looking at, and we discussed the previous Friday with our engineers, was that we actually go ahead and look at probably acquiring some of this stone now and literally laying it on the other side of the stone wall. Would it be reused later when we rebuild it? Definitely. It isn't like it's going to... But we're talking stones. If you put the three of your desks together, that would be a small stone.
Right. We're talking about what's down there on the state wall.
Exactly.
Right. These stones take flatbeds to move.
Yep.
You need something with a hand that can lift them one by one. The trucks take, get damaged, loading them. So there's select contractors and select people who actually even have the stone available.
Are we talking about, the possibility that wall could collapse?
It would just settle in place because the soil around it would be eroded, and then it would allow in a lot of, possibly, during a storm, a lot of ocean water. What would be that effect? It would leave a lot of sand on Route 1 in that area.
We have to remember that in the early 1700s, in the history of this town, that there was a northeaster freshet that came through this very area and eroded the entire area all the way down and filled up what is now Meadow Pond. Now, the ocean resealed that, so the town didn't have to do anything back in those colonial days to do that. The ocean sealed itself up. But there's a lot of houses down there now. There's a lot of condominiums down there now, and all that water is going to have to go down where they are, which is a little bit more than they were planning on for the drainage system that they have. So,
Mr. Chairman, may I?
Sure.
I'm reading from the 21 December 2016 inter-office memo. It's to the town manager. It's from Jennifer Hale. She's the deputy. Page one, it says that the New Hampshire Department of Transportation outfall pipe is broken, which is causing further erosion on the beach. I would request that we make liaison with NHDOT, ask for their, then would like that in writing, and how much they're going to subsidize our effort on this if it in fact is causing damage. We'll go into the deep pockets of the state on that one. Continuing on, it says there's swelling and deterioration of the wall's structural stability. A poured half million yards of concrete, both underground, under the ocean, and at the nuclear power plant. That is an ominous, ominous statement. The wall is not sitting on or connected to bedrock. Another ominous, ominous statement. The bedrock was found to be 10 feet to 16 feet below the sand. Based on the investigation results and wave alternative scenarios, the existing seawall has a marginal factor of safety and stability. I remind you that people bring their children down there. I remind you that people have their children sitting on the wall. I'll further extrapolate my comments that we should be shutting that down and posting that. I've discussed that already.
We're going to fence it this week.
May I please continue? Thank you. This is a huge, Esquire has talked about effluent and liability issues. This goes south, and I am less sagacious than to be able to predict which way that wall would fall and if there would be loss of human life if it did occur. It could bankrupt the town. And that doesn't speak to the tragedy of this ominous threat sitting there as it does. There's a potential that in extreme wave conditions, there could be failure. And again, people go down there, and it is a natural driver for people to go down around the ocean. Young people, old runners like Jim,
hey,
bunch of people. If you further examine the, is it Tigbond?
Tigbond.
Attachment B. It's got Bravo 1, Bravo 2, and Bravo 3 for the post in the drilling. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah. I was down there when they were doing it, kind of fascinated by this, got a couple of minutes. If you go to B1, down to 20 feet, there's nothing here but soft sand.
Right.
You've studied this. So you've got dozens and dozens and dozens of failing concrete sitting on sand with the Atlantic Ocean pounding it. So I'm going to say that again. Dozens and dozens of tons with public access sitting on soft sand. If you go to Bravo 2, at 15 feet on their sample description, at 15 feet says there's no recovery. Does that mean there's...
They didn't recover a sample when they pulled it out.
Okay. Again, ominous. There's no indication of what that is. But again, you go down that far to 20 feet, loose, dark gray gravel and slip clay. If you go to Bravo 3, the same thing, 5 feet, 10 feet, 15 feet. 15 feet is light gray, silty clay, little gravel, little organics, and fine trace sand. So again, this is ominous. It's a huge liability issue. It's a top priority. When we speak of these issues about the state, when we speak about legislators in Concord giving away our millions of dollars, it adds up. It is, in fact, infuriating. And when we look at these priorities, again, these are life safety issues. This, to me, right behind, this needs to be shut down and posted. If not 2 weeks, I think immediately it needs to be posted. And then in terms of priorities, for a life safety issue, this is it. And for organics to the town, it is the main force. So this, I would recommend, be posted on the website as part of our responsibilities, if it has not been already. And the secondary issue is that there's a life safety issue, and it rises to the highest level from the command element. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any other?
I don't have anything further to add.
Nothing further to add.
Rick?
No, I'm all for it. I think it's something that we can see needs to be done.
Right. So we have a motion. Now, do you want to amend that to the $2 million as they've suggested so far, or do you want to?
The dollar value will change, you know, as they give us the final number, as we come before you to discuss the options.
I understand we do not have a final design or engineering contract on this. So it was really just this preliminary investigation and to get us up.
And what was that figure at?
What did we say?
Last year's
Oh, the engineering?
Yeah.
It would probably be 10% upwards.
No, what have they given you as preliminary figures now for this?
What have they given me for preliminary? I haven't seen a preliminary figure.
We don't have the ones for the three alternates they've given us. We've put in a placeholder of 2.2 million. That is not a figure associated with the three alternatives that I would come with because we haven't gotten those yet.
Right.
Best guess, 202.
202. So the motion is to accept it.
202.
202.
2,200,000.
2,200,000. All those in favor? Unanimous.
May I just tag on to that a little bit unrelated to the Warren article? As Fred mentioned, we've already contacted some fence companies to come in and block this area off. The idea was to go to the back of the parking spaces, so still allow the parking that is there, but keep people off the wall and the sand area down Route 1. And so that they cannot get onto the wall area at all.
How about on the beach side? Is there a danger there that somebody's sitting, on the beach side of the wall? Because when I look at that, it...
The way the report reads is that we have the marginal stability, as it stands. The concern is in a large event. I am... not being sarcastic, say this, but I am hoping that in the high tide, large event area, that there isn't anybody at the bottom of the wall because the water does come right up to it. But to your point,
in the short period, there could be God forbid, someone playing or scavenging, if you will,
beach glassing or whatever,
and a piece of concrete fall off the wall. I think as a minimum, we'll put up an orange construction fence with some no trespassing signs.
I think that would be smart.
May have to go find this fence once or twice.
Yeah. You can paint that wall as many people tag walls. Yeah. You can paint that wall tomorrow subject to further markings.
So I just wanted to make sure everybody was on board with that, that it does get fenced off. No trespassing signs will be put up. No public access.
And we'll be notifying at least 2 federal agencies and 3 or 4 state agencies of it.
So that was my tag on to that one.
So the next one we have is Article 20, as it's labeled right now, for refuse collection trucks, transport semi-trailers, and other equipment. Will the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $1,300,000 to the purchase of replacement equipment and materials to permit the continued collection and transportation of solid waste and recycling materials from the town of Hampton and to disposal locations by the Department of Public Works through the purchase of 4 double-arm automated heavy-duty refuse collection Mack trucks and 4 100 cubic yard hydraulic ram solid waste transfer vehicles with a fire hose coupling as specified by the fire department, and one yard tractor to permit the movement and of the equipment within the Department of Yard and Public Works, and 1 professional high pressure steam cleaner for the maintenance of solid waste collection and transport equipment, to authorize the issuance of serial bonds or notes to a period not to exceed 5 years in the amount of $1,300,000 in accordance with provisions of the Municipal Finance Act, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen and the Treasurer to issue and negotiate such bonds and notes determined by the best interest, and all the rest of the stuff we talked about before, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen and the Town Treasurer to bother anticipation notes.
Where'd Chris go?
You just need to step out for 1 minute.
Okay. Does the department still want to proceed with this, or... Yeah. Want to modify it, or?
It needs to be modified because we need to look at the discussion of everything that has come to light since we've submitted all the articles. I'm also looking for this one because it did get modified from a previous version where we had just the trailers and the yard horse. Can we come back to this one?
Sure.
Let's come back.
We'll come back to it.
And we will come back to it. Winnicott Road
complete street and highway sidewalk projects. Town of Hampton vote to a raise appropriate the sum of $1 million. Such appropriation to be offset by the reimbursement from the Transportation Alternative Program, TAP, funding estimated at $800,000 for the purpose of constructing a complete street along the Winneconnet Road, including the creation of new sidewalks on both north and south sides, pedestrian crossings, traffic calming techniques, landscaping, and new signage for the Center School to Mill Road, and the construction of a new sidewalk along the north side of High Street between Toby and Five Corners, where there currently is none. It is recommended by the Safe Routes to School Plan and to provide a choice for the non-motorized users for a safe, reliable, convenient, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for or accept any federal, state, or other available funds towards the project in accordance with the terms and conditions under which they are received and borrow in anticipation and the receipt of such funds provided the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, through the issuance of municipal bonds and notes for a period not to exceed 30 years. To authorize the Board of Selectmen and the Town Treasurer to issue and negotiate such bonds, notes, and determine the state of interest, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to implement such cost-effective solutions that are presented in the future as they deem in the best interest of the towns that may result in a lesser amount of expenditure than authorized by this warrant article, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to take any and all actions necessary to carry out the project in the best interest of the Town of Hampton. This is a non-lapsing appropriation, and it shall not lapse until the project is completed on March 31st, 2019, whichever is sooner. Three-fifths vote required. And a note, as the TAP funding is a reimbursement project, the project total is estimated to be at $1 million. However, upon reimbursement, it is expected that the total cost of the project will be $200,000. Do we have, do you want to explain? Do you want to have a motion first? And I'll make a motion and we have a second so we can
talk about it. I'll second it.
All right.
As you may recall, this was a project that came before you to receive your permission to submit to the state our application for the project. It was rated number 2 in Rockingham County. They have not made final decisions, so we do not know where we stand at this point as to receiving the reimbursement funding. But as the articles require, this would be a complete streets improvement. This would include the traffic calming that we were talking about, the slowing, the parking, the sidewalks to do the connectivity, most importantly from Center School across Town Hall, the library, attach it to Academy, even with or without, you know, the Academy project moving forward, taking it down to Mill Road and getting people across. It was one of the projects identified as part of the Safe Routes to School study that was conducted with the school board and the other members in town. And it's a great opportunity if we're selected to receive that kind of reimbursement to make such significant improvements.
Will we know before we do this that we'll have the TAP grant coming in?
According to our pre-application mandatory meetings we went to, they told us December.
So we should know in December if we're going to have this money. So right. we'd have to appropriate all of it.
Correct.
But we'll get probably $800,000 back if we're approved.
If they give us the $800,000 we asked for in our application.
If we're not approved, then we pay the $1 million?
Yep.
If the voters choose to move forward with the warrant article, right. Yes. Right.
But we'll know by December.
So can we?
We can move forward with this now.
And then?
We can pull it back at any time, can't we?
If you don't put it in the warrant, it's dead.
You don't put what in the warrant?
This article. If you approve it now, but if we fail to put it in the warrant, then it's a dead issue.
So can we make the warrant subject to the reimbursement? Not either or.
Certainly you can. Yep.
I would move to amend. This is, has been presented.
Put that provision in.
Subject to approval of the TAP grant.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Otherwise, then you could do the verbiage, Mr. Welsh.
Yep. Not a problem. We do modified contingencies all the time. The only question I'd have with regards to this is, because I see it's in quotes, it says complete street. At the municipal conference, we were told the complete street programs means that on all these streets, there would be absolutely no parking on either side.
And that's why I put it in quotes.
Is that correct? So for this entire area on Winnicott on Winnicott Road would have no parking for the entire length of the project.
No, that's not what we'd be proposing.
Right. I mean, it's
okay.
Complete to them meant that you'd taken care of all your underground infrastructure up through that you hadn't done the top dressing only. And the parking was a function of what the residents and the butters and the community determined when.
I think you need to take the quotations off of that. That's what we need to do.
Complete street.
Would you like me?
Because the complete street concept, as is explained to me at the conference, is that eliminates all parking on that street for that project area.
To avoid confusion, should we take complete streets out of it and just use the descriptions of the improvements?
Or we just say we're completing the street?
Street constructing street improvements along Winnicott, including new sidewalks on the boat. Like, just say street improvements.
Yeah, because one's a program and the other is not.
Okay.
Thank you.
I don't want to ban parking on Winnicott Road. That's probably not
okay,
good
so my
idea.
Motion... Did I make the motion?
Or did you made the motion.
You made the motion, so right. You're making it...
We're amending the motion contingent. To have that verbiage.
Contingent
upon the receiving the grant.
Yep.
Right.
And contingent upon...
Using street improvements instead of complete streets.
Right.
Good.
So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous. Paving Highway Block Grant.
It's element number six.
Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise appropriate sum of $650,000 for improvements to streets consisting of paving overlays, adjustments to structures to prevent paving, repairs, and replace the damage and crack ceiling, curbing installation, and improvements to the following streets: Ann's Lane, Merrill Industrial Drive, Drake Side Road, including the paving and roadway construction required and the removal of the railroad trestle abutments. Said appropriations will be offset by the highway block grant of an estimated $307,854. This will be a non-lapsing appropriation, RSA 32-76, and shall not lap until the projects are completed or by March 31st, 2018, whichever occurs sooner. So,
That is what we are proposing. It sort of covers everything from crack sealing to the Ann's Lane paving, Merrill Industrial Drive. They both were on our paving reconstruction plans and thus put forward for the next ones to be done. Drake Side Road would be done in conjunction with removing the railroad trestle abutments. In the roadway reconstruction, so that whole roadway would be repaved with this fund.
And one of the reasons we're doing that is I know over the past less than a month, we've had two storms that have flooded that trestle out, and we've had vehicles flooded out that were in there.
Yes.
So
moved.
So I have a motion.
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Four. One abstention from Rick, wherever he's at. So the next one for you guys is
Vehicles 24.
Yep, Vehicles 24. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $350,000 for the purchase of the following replacement vehicles: the Department of Public Works, one-ton truck with a dump body and a plow, one sidearm packer. Be replaced, so the vehicles traded with the replaced vehicles being traded if deemed prudent by the Public Works Director, Town Manager, and the Board of Selectmen. This is a non-lapsing appropriation and shall not be lapsed until the purchase is completed or by March 31st, 2018, which is ever sooner. So,
I think that's a neutral appropriation. It's the same as this year in round figures.
Yes.
Yeah.
I have a motion and second it for discussion?
I'll make the motion to.
All right. Second.
Yes, sir.
Have some discussion. What you're looking to replace and why you're.
You want to go or you want me to?
Well, this follows the CIP plan that we put together. I was trying to follow the wording as you.
So we have one ton.
Right. One rear loaded Packer, replacement of our yard horse. For those that don't know, the yard horse was dropped on yours because it was on ours.
Yeah, we have it. The basically the two that are on here. Yeah, this one got changed.
Okay, this one got over.
Oops, we lost one of my pages. The one sidearm Packer came up as the vehicle to replace because we've been facing, and I think we brought this up at the last selectman's meeting, significant challenges with the maintenance of these vehicles. To the extent that we still have one vehicle down that's now been down almost, 3 weeks?
Correct.
And we can't be without a vehicle. We can't be without that trash truck. It takes twice as many people to put them on the rear loader. Our demand is increasing. So the need is there for one of the sidearm Packers. The article that we, what was the word we... We'll talk about later, the one that when Chris had stepped out, that has this one-arm Packer in it. So that was why, you know, it was sort of like, let's talk about this or let's talk about the other article. Overall, it's a solid waste issue for the one-arm Packer. It's not just this one-arm Packer in here.
It's all.
It, you know, we need trailers for the storing of the refuge to be able to haul it up. The one-ton truck is to replace, you know, one of our oldest in the fleet.
And as you know, I'm working on the solid waste study, as I explained to the manager a number of weeks ago. One of the phases of that was to back up and look at what has it cost us over the last 5 years. I believe I broached that subject when I was here for my quarterly report, that those three trucks over the last 5 years have cost the department in excess of $200,000 just for maintenance.
These three vehicles?
The three one-arm Packers, and that's why that's why this particular article has been amended from previous year's CIPs to move one of those vehicles into replacement now, because we're just exceeding our budget. By comparison, the rear Packers, the ones where you literally put the trash in on the rear end of the vehicles, the five-year maintenance pattern on those was in the area of $100,000. So it's almost a 2-to-1 maintenance-wise for these sidearm Packers. They're while they are very efficient on the road, and they don't require the need of other people, i.e. workers on the backside, to move the carts, they are very expensive vehicles to maintain. So at present, vehicle 92, as we said, have been down for 3 weeks. We're able to use our other trucks, plus taking away two guys out of highway so we can run a rear Packer, able to collect our refuse every day. But what this particular truck's in for is a $6,000 to $7,000 rebuild of the gas
regeneration
system. For those who don't know, it actually captures the soot, the black gas that you'd see in a diesel, and sends it back for a reburn through the engine. Part of it has to be cooled a little bit, and then before it can be reburned. And those systems on these trucks are very they're costly to maintain. As I said before, we didn't pick the right truck 5 years ago. These trucks should have been short haul, like over the road, where they're running 40 miles to a place and 50 miles to another place on a daily basis, instead of stop go, stop go, stop go, because it's the engines. This is not what they were built for.
Well, the point that it's not just our problem. It's any of the trucks that were made with that type of regeneration system.
Right.
They don't use that anymore.
Right. It's a 2007 International.
They don't use that anymore because it failed, because you have to have that truck get out on the road and burn.
Yeah.
And these don't.
Matter of fact, the first one that went down when we called the repair shop, they said, we described the problem. They said, oh, you must have a 2007 International. And we said, well, yeah, how did you know? They've all had to been rebuilt. Oh, okay. So,
because if you can't get it out on the road to burn that off, what happens is the system gets clogged, and then you have to do that. Owning one, a diesel that's that vintage, I know exactly what it is.
Can you modify the truck so it doesn't do that, or no?
Put in a new engine.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you have to repower it.
And it's been a, a domino's effect. The first time we go in and replace, you know, the regulating valve, the next thing is the filter, and the next thing after the filter is the joint that's holding it together, and then times it by three because we have three of these trucks. So we're just finding in the last, you know, 5 months.
How we discovered it is when we did an oil change, we realized we had radiator fluid in our oil, but it wasn't passing out through the radiator itself. It was passing out through these EGR. Gas.
The new systems use the DEF fluid, so they don't. It works totally different.
That was surprisingly one of the savings that was touted to us in writing back 5 years ago. That, hey, you won't have to buy that fluid.
Mr. Chairman, yes. Since we pulled the other article for further work, why don't we pull this one and work them together so that we end up with a total solution?
And then I can get back to you. I mean, just for your information, the one ton was the one ton that we ejected from the fleet last year that we didn't get replaced. It's one of our paving vehicles.
Okay. So we'll hold off on 24 as it's written. 25, Road Improvements Capital Reserve Fund. So I'm here to vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $300,000 to be added to the Road Capital Investment Capital Reserve Fund created under Article 16 of the 1998 Annual Town Meeting in accordance with provisions RSA 35 for the purpose and maintenance and reconstruction of the streets.
I'll move that.
Move and second it. This is just a...
This is the same article that's been before the town, I believe, for the previous 4 years or 5 years, I guess.
Yeah.
It's one that I wholeheartedly support, and we've actually targeted that. At the end of this year, it's going to have that fund will have $1.2 million in it. So at the end of December 31, 2017, it would have $1.5 million in it. Lo and behold, when we get done the Lafayette Road sewer replacement, we would then want to proceed on with doing the drainage improvements because we have a number of drainage issues in that same section. 1.5 is actually the money that it would take to reconstruct sidewalks, curbing, landscaping, some new street lighting down that from the intersection where LeMay's Tavern is all the way south to the galley hatch is $1.5 million. So if this fund continues to build and accrue as it has, as one former selectman put it, it should go to a much larger project. This would be the project that we have identified. So we're in support of it.
Any questions? Motion and second. All those in favor? Unanimous. Next one is asset management of stormwater and wastewater assets. So the town of Hampton vote to raise appropriate sum of $60,000 to assist the Department of Public Works in the development of an asset management program for stormwater and wastewater assets. Said appropriation is to be offset by $60,000 in the principal load forgiveness under the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services Clean Water State Revolving Fund and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for and contract for acceptance of any federal, state, and other available funds towards the project in accordance with the terms and conditions under which they are received, and to borrow in anticipation of the receipt of such an issuance of such bonds as notes as provided in the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, as amended, and to authorize participation of the State Revolving Fund, SRFO, RSA 468:14, established for the purpose of, and authorize the Board of Selectmen to accept and expend such monies as they become available from federal and state governments. This shall be a non-lapsing appropriation per RSA 32.76 and shall not lapse until the project is completed or by March 31st, 2019, which is ever sooner. Another mouthful. So, would you like to explain that?
Yes. Basically, this is my year-long project of trying to implement asset management software. We've gone through the process, received quotes, have been here, told you about that. This is the program where the state is willing to give $60,000 in loan forgiveness to buy our software, asset management software program, to buy the tablets and supporting hardware that is needed to implement the program is this $60,000. The idea is that we borrow $60,000, they give us $60,000 back. It is here as a warrant article because it is considered a loan, and that takes approval of the town.
I'll make the motion.
Motion, second. Okay. Any other questions? All those in favor? Unanimous. The next one is Article 27 as written. Three new DPW employees. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise and appropriate the sum of $68,000 for the purpose of employing and equipping three full-time employees for the town of Hampton Department of Public Works. This shall be a non-lapsing appropriation for RSA 3276 and shall not elapse until the hiring is completed or by March 31st, 2018, which is ever sooner.
This is the same or similar warrant article that we've brought forward for the last, this will be the third year. The previous 2 years, I believe there was some, as I say, concessions made, give and take, and this article actually never really made it forward to the town warrant article. It goes back to the, if you will, the root of the problem, in that for those 12 to 13 weeks during the summer, I really don't have, the town does not really have a highway department. Everybody's on solid waste, period. We looked at, you know, why is this situation continuing to occur? When we originally instituted the solid waste program 5 years ago, we bought 10,000 carts. We've handed out, and we continue to buy carts every single year. There's a $10,000 line in the budget to buy more carts. Well, we buy those carts and we've handed them up. The town has, at least the solid waste portion of our job has grown to the point we're picking up just under 15,000 carts a day, or in the course of a week, we pick them all up once, but yes, some of them more than once. But we're picking up in excess of 15,000 carts. Day after day during those 13 weeks, they literally come in, you know, 5 minutes before the end of their shift or 15 minutes after the end of their shift, because they're just straight out all day long. So I don't have anybody to go around and trim brush, put up signs. Earlier this summer, you passed a warrant article to change signs on Ann's Terrace, to change the to put a stop sign in, speed limit sign, and to move the two do not enter signs. The work didn't get done for almost 8 weeks because it occurred like in June, early July. And I explained to the residents who asked you for it that, yeah, I'll get to it, and I've got the signs, I'll order them, but I don't have a sign crew because they're all working, doing that. Immediately after Seafood Festival, up until this past Tuesday, the Tuesday before Thanksgiving, we were still milling and patching potholes. Why do we do it in that time period? Because that's the only time period we have. It's the only time period we have for a crew to do it. Because it's a
three to five man operation, depending on the streets. So things are just not getting done. We are maxed out workload wise with the people that we have. We're just not getting it done. So for the third time, and I'm confident in the $68,000 number because Teresa put it together. She looked at the wage rate schedule, where they'd be starting, and this is just hourly wage. It's not health insurance. It's not benefits or anything else. But we need at least three other people so that we can have a highway crew during the summer, a four- to five-man highway crew. Right now, some days, Al Jones is the highway crew. And all he can literally do is fasten a bolt on a stop sign or
attend to a fallen branch. Or, I mean, it can be whatever is needed. It becomes priority. Exactly. We go into priority mode.
I mean, I literally have even like the sewer and drain division now doing some of the highway division's work because, A, it's an emergency. It has to get done. And, B, I have nobody else to do it. So this is... This is how we're operating.
I would offer this, Mr. Chairman, is that it's going to be an extraordinary pressure with both the school request and the municipal request. And then I'm hearing about brush. I'm hearing about putting up signs. Those do not rise to the level of some of the exigencies that we have. There are many subcontractors for services. We talk about Jamco to remove snow. There are many landscapers out here. There are many people that we can subcontract without pension benefits, without health care. If someone comes in that's hired and has a family plan, that could be $30,000 a year. So these numbers, while they just reveal salary, could be triple. Is that $68,000 an annual figure or a partial figure?
The annual figure.
That's the annual figure. So it's not reflective. It could double with benefits and pension costs. And the level that I'm hearing from the director and assistant director is for putting up signs, for cutting brush. And that's always been the way it's been. You and I both work for Public Works. It's stressed out, and I don't support putting full-time employees on the town of Hampton to cut brush and to put up signs at this juncture. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'm going to agree with Selectman Bean, and I hate to, because I know you need the people, and you know, and I hate to bring this up, but this is reality. Solid waste pickup is overwhelming the town. Mm-hmm. It's got to be looked at again at some point. And I know that a couple of years ago people said they wanted it, but you're overwhelming a department with one function. And that really needs to be, and you have a lot of questions on it, on other issues, that really needs to be looked at. But on this issue, I agree with Selectman Bean. I'd much rather fight for the sewers than right now for new employees. I'm sorry, but that's...
Well, the way I feel is, this is the third or fourth or fifth time that this has come up. Their work is not getting any less. It is getting more. And we've seen the fact that stuff is not getting done because they have to do this. Didn't the... who's the guy that was the... Not the engineer, but that went out, was on one of the Packers at one day picking up trash this summer.
Oh, our engineering technician this summer.
Right.
Who's... We lost him for half the summer just
because he was out on a trash truck picking up trash. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there was a lot of other important stuff that he could have been doing instead of picking up trash. I know it's you hear that it's just signs, but it's also potholes. It's also the sides of the roads. It's the brush, and that's the stuff that we're letting go. And we let go the sewer line on Route 1 for years and years and years, and now it's coming back to bite us. We can't keep letting go all these projects. It's been a long time since we put any new manpower on in this town, especially in the public works. We've heard time and time again, this is the one department that needs the manpower. And I support this warrant article.
I'd like to When was the, can I ask a question? When was the last time that we've actually staffed Public Works?
I've been here 5 years. It's always been 41 people.
And now we have condos, you know, potential development down in the western part of town, approving for signs to get put up, and then they're not getting put up for legitimate reason. There's no one to put them up. You know, explaining to the taxpayers that the signs that you want didn't get put up because our engineers are picking up trash, as Chairman Bridle stated. So I think that we should put it out there, and we need to let the town look at it again. With everything that's gone on the past year, with things that have been requested and had to wait on for the reason that you just don't have enough manpower. Mm-hmm. And I think that I support this article, that it goes to town meeting and that the voters can decide on what they want to do with it.
How many feet of road have we put in the past 5 or 6 years? New roads. How many new houses are on those roads that we need to pick up? How many new sewer lines and sewer connections that we need to maintain and take care of?
Yeah.
You know,
it's all true, but again, it's a larger picture that we're not dealing with.
That number $68,000 is not the true cost.
Yeah, it's a larger picture that the larger picture is not being dealt with. And that's the trash issue. That why should a whole department, DPW, be dealing solely with trash? I know that's a very touchy subject, but
we've dealt with that in the past, and it's come up many times in the past, and many times that has failed.
Then
what?
But I agree with Selectman Bean too, that this, it's $68,000. That doesn't include benefits.
This could double under benefits. And Mr. Welch, if I could ask you, what is our responsibility, the taxpayers, on this warrant, to put $68,000? That means for three people, what's the math? $22,000 a person?
About that, yeah.
Okay, and then you add the pension contribution for your class of employees is what, 10 points, 15 points?
7.4.
There's another 5,400 in that. Health insurance, if you hire three family guys, you're at another 60,000. And we have an obligation to have those two costs in the warrant, and they can't be excluded.
Then let's send it back, and why don't you see what those costs would be? Talk with the financial people and see if we can bring it back so we have an actual cost of this.
What about part-time?
That's what the $68,000 looks like, part-time, not full-time.
Well, I could possibly know one or two candidates that live in Hampton that might be interested in a part-time position with Public Works. So would that be something that...
We did, a couple of years ago, have two part-time people, but with the board's approval, we melded those into one permanent person.
Because this guy, he's retired, you know, just looking for something to do.
We already use a part-time person at the transfer station. We use a part-time person in the wastewater treatment plant, and we do have...
part-time in the mechanics division.
Right. We even have
them.
Three. Four.
What we do with them, and then
college-age kids that we hire to work in solid waste during the summer. That is part of the budget. But
okay.
Yeah, and that may be a partial solution to this, is that we hire more part-timers.
So why don't we move it along till it's decided if they're going to be part-time, or what is the real price for full-time?
So hold this one and come back.
Yeah, we'll pull that back and come back with it.
Why don't we come back, too, with the cost of contracting the workout?
Mm-hmm.
Contracting the positions out?
No, the roadside mowing, the sign put up, and da 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 da. All the stuff that you're trying to get done, but you can't get to.
Yeah, we'd like to see a third party possibly do it.
Okay, so the next article is Article 28. Shall the town of Hampton vote and raise appropriate the sum of $25,000 for the maintenance, repair, and reconstruction and replacement of sidewalks? This should be a non-lapsing portion for RSA 2276 and shall not lapse until a project is completed on March 31st, 2018, whichever is sooner. Again, this is an article that we've had for many years. It's we did some replacement this year, which they did ADA requirements. They also replaced a stretch up on High Street that was
Last year was the full previously we always carried $25,000 to $26,000 for sidewalk replacement, and it wasn't sufficient. Last year, the proposal came forward, and the voters approved to put an additional $45,000 to it, and actually, you know, marry something together and get it actually done. Jennifer's worked hard this year. We had to bid it out twice. We tried combining it with the schools project. We finally got someone to bid on it, and then we rode them hard and got done and spent every cent of it getting done the sidewalks that we did. Seeing that that was what the voters asked us to do last year, that's why we came up with essentially the same warrant article this year.
Any questions? Any motion?
My motion.
Second?
Yeah.
All those in favor? Unanimous. 28 is written, wastewater treatment plant energy audit. Shall the town of Hampton vote to raise appropriate sum of $16,060 for a contract to detail process level energy for the town of Hampton wastewater treatment plant facility and pump stations. Said appropriations will be offset by $16,600 from a principal loan forgiveness under the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services Clean Water State Revolving Fund, and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to apply for and accept and expend any federal, state, or other funds available to the project in accordance with the terms and conditions under which they received, and to borrow the anticipation and receipt of such aid and the issuance of such bonds or notes provided by the Municipal Finance Act, RSA 33, as amended, and to authorize participation in state revolving SRF, RSA 486:14, establish the purpose of the authorized the Board of Selectmen to apply for, accept, and expend such monies to become available from the federal and state governments. It shall be a non-lapsing appropriation and shall not lapse until the completion of March 31st, 2019, or whichever occurs sooner. Again, this is a loan that will be, we have to apply for it, but we already know we're going to get it if we apply for it.
Correct.
So, but because it is a contract, we have to.
Because it is where we will actually be borrowing the money and then forgiven, we have to put it to the town as a warrant.
All right.
I make a motion that we approve this warrant article 29 for the sum of $16,060.
Second by Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous. I believe the last one we have for Public Works is the Article 30 as written for a household hazardous waste collection. Shall the town of Hampton vote to authorize and pay the sum of $15,000 to conduct a hazardous waste collection day during the calendar year 2017 and to authorize the Board of Selectmen to print the towns of Hampton Falls and Newcastle to participate in said collection at their own expense and to apply for and accept and expend any such purposes from the state of New Hampshire or federal government and to any private source that may become available. This is like we did this year. Didn't we do this with this, with
we did
same article,
and we did it with Newcastle and Hampton Falls. And how well did it work this year?
Worked very well. We had total participants 203. 188 were from Hampton, 4 from Hampton Falls, and 11 from Newcastle. There were 4 heavy cars, and there was an additional 8 drop-offs, like ahead of time for. So the total was really about 215 cars. So it worked out rather well.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Is that all the ones you have in here right now, I believe?
That's enough.
I think that's all the DPWs.
I have a question. Just throw something out there before they leave. Have we ever looked at contracting waste pickup?
Well, 5 years ago, we were contracting out waste pickup, and one of the things that was happening was the company, who shall not name publicly, if their drivers maxed out on their hours, let's say halfway through Friday morning, they just went back to the landfill, and that was the end of the day. And if certain streets got missed, the adage was, well, it's trash, nobody's going to steal it, just leave it, we'll get it next week. Well, you can only have so many next weeks. And that's really what prompted the town to then, we were already, I think, picking up recycling, was to then say, no, we're going to pick up refuse too. And the residents felt that they were not getting the level of service that for what they were paying. And the cost, and Rick will, we talked about it before, the comparison was, yeah, we could get it done for about the same amount of money to purchase the trucks and the pay for the labor. We didn't quite take into account new tires, but essentially, yeah, it's a wash.
It was supposed to be lower.
But is it a wash when you're losing the ability to do other things?
Well, and we didn't take into account depreciation of the trucks and maintenance of the trucks. Those two things make it a real loss.
Well, they took it all into account, but we were informed differently.
Right.
I don't even remember what the first part, what you said, you know, about the citizens going along with it. I don't even remember anything like that. Mm-hmm. But there was some issues with the company, Waste Management, and they caused a problem. And I can't quite remember exactly what it was, but Mr. Welch, you must know, it had something to do with hundreds of thousands of dollars.
There was some mix-up in the way things were expended and paid for it. Nothing illegal. But we went out and bid the process, and they gave several hundred thousand dollars above what it cost us to do it ourselves.
Okay.
We picked up all the refuge, and they picked up the recyclables.
Yes.
Oh, okay. So it's backwards from what you said, but they picked up our recyclables.
Okay. Right? But what I'm saying is, is that worth taking a look at a different way of doing it to save? Because what we're saying is, in the summer we use all our people on refuge only.
And that's the study that I started. Still gathering some information. Interrupted by us.
Okay.
Holidays and the budget process, but it is something I still am working on.
Okay.
But it wasn't trash pickup, it was recycling.
It was recycling. That's correct.
Yeah. So maybe that needs to be looked at.
And I think what it may lead to is, in fact, we may try and bid it out again just to see if it's worth it. Maybe we just solicit a request for qualifications. Given this, how much would you, and see, you know, it's, I think it's always worth, especially for the basis of determining rational fees and how it affects the tax rate, it's always worth looking at it.
I would just offer this as well, Mr. Chairman, if I may, before Public Works leaves, in terms of the Affordable Care Act, and we're all subject to that. We have many good town employees, and we keep a tight lid on the 32-hour limit. And I've heard job descriptions for what we're looking at for the summer surge.
Yep.
Other departments in town have part-time employees, and I would be very sensitive to that issue. For a full-time employee, you could be an 18-year-old young man or woman and marry an older person with four kids, and you go to a family plan. And those numbers cannot be budgeted, and you cannot discriminate. And I do not support for that skill level. That type of indulgence at the taxpayer's pocket for that service. And I will not support any notion of that for those job descriptions that we're describing.
Hampton has a long history of hiring people during the summertime.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Very good. So, what else? We have a discussion. It's a draft warrant articles. Request for the budget committee. We have a request for money warrant articles.
Public Works,
are they finished?
Yeah, they are finished. Sorry.
Thank you.
Sorry, I thought you knew that. Sorry. I thought we said we were going to only do theirs and that we were done
with
yours.
Thank you.
Thank you for reminding me. So, request to the budget committee. One is money warrant articles.
Mr. Chairman, if the board approves, I will be happy to send on the warrant articles that you have tentatively approved for inclusion within the warrant.
It's fine by me.
I think that solves that problem.
Okay. Hampton Police Department inquiries on private details.
I think
that with your permission, Mr. Chairman, the board's permission, I'll get together with the chief of police and he can answer those questions. They had private details to deal with the police department. I think the chief is probably the best person in the world to answer that.
And what are the questions?
I don't know. I haven't been asked them yet.
Are they operational or are they accounting and finance?
I think they're operational. Assignment operational.
What does that mean?
In other words, certain members of the budget committee feel the chief shouldn't be assigning himself paid details anywhere, anytime. I think they had quite a discussion on that.
I didn't. Yeah, we did, but I mean, it's not like we sat down and agreed that we were going to solicit
the chairman of the budget committee had sent a request in.
Right. Okay.
What are your feelings as the representative?
What are my feelings as a representative?
I think you discussed it.
On the budget committee.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't discuss it.
Okay. No, I'm just...
But I believe that the assistant town manager and the chief of police...
I think the police chief of police should be here if we're going to discuss it.
Yeah.
Well, here's my point is we have an established SOP that's been voted on by this board for lines of communication requests that go from liaison.
And it doesn't go that way.
Well, that's how we roll. And that's been voted on by the selectmen. Happy to provide information, but there's formal lines of communication. And then there's the secondary issue of budget committee does not do operations. Budget committee does not pass judgment on what the chief of police in the town of Hampton decides to do with his operational capabilities, with his liaison, developing compatible and joint horizontal capabilities with first aid responding forces, CERT capabilities. It's a whole different ball of wax.
Right.
So if you've got operational inquiries from the budget committee, that's not happening.
These are operational.
That's not happening.
I agree 100% with Phil that if it's a budget issue, pass it right on. If it's not a budget issue, if it's an operational issue, I don't see where they should be involved.
It's not their bailiwick.
Not right.
Okay. Next one is the cemetery budget requirement.
Inquiries. I suggest as we send a message back to the budget committee, tell them they should correspond with the cemetery commissioners if they have questions on their budget.
Okay.
I agree.
And the default budget inquiries.
They haven't enumerated any inquiries with regards to the default budget, other than they don't like it. So they need to actually send this board a missive telling them exactly what, and through the channels, exactly what their inquiry is. And they haven't done that.
Well, that's fine through the channels, but when Mary Louise goes and emails other people, then we should just ignore it then, because it's not going through the proper channels.
That's the instructions from the previous instructions from the board.
When I find out about it from a forward email from you,
right,
it doesn't do me any good. So,
and the default budget, that is set by us.
That is correct, sir.
It's not set by any other department.
That is correct.
It's not set by any other person.
Yep.
That is set by the Board of Selectmen.
That's
so
correct.
If they want questions on the default budget, then they should come through the our representative on that budget and bring them back to us.
And they should be very specific in their nature.
Absolutely. Okay.
Well said.
Closing comments. Anybody have closing comments?
Mr. Chairman, I would just ask the board, I know it's late, but me too. RSA 90, if we could have a motion for a non-public session under RSA 91-A:3, Roman 2, small c, reputation, and small e, litigation. I appreciate
make that
it.
Motion.
So move. I need a roll call vote. Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Good night, Max.
See you, Max.
See you, Max.